Due to a David Turner fuck-up, the sound quality of this week's show is below par. Jamie's already planning his attack.
Hello and welcome to the Computer Game Show. My name's David Turner. I'm joined by Matt Murray.
Hello.
Sean Bell.
Hello.
And James Farley.
Why am I last this time?
Does it matter? Team back again. Sorry about last week. I did listen to the show.
Whoa. What are you apologising for? There's nothing wrong with it.
Well, I mean...
Are we going straight into follow-up?
Yeah. Do we have any follow-up, Matt?
Well, no, the first bit of follow-up, I want to hear from you.
Well, I thought it was a good show. I thought Gary Dutton did himself proud last week. It was a very good appearance from him. Don't think Timor really wanted to be there. And, you know, I don't really blame Timor. Kind of blame Sean for his man management was absolutely appalling last week. And I think
management, is that that's a term? Okay,
go on. You've never heard that term before?
Man management, no.
Yeah. Oh, really? You need to get into football, Lid. Champion Rovers is all about it, yeah. So, yeah, that was... I mean, what were you playing at last week, Sean? I mean, if I'm going to hand over the reins in future, probably not going to be to you. Because, firstly, right, let me just...
It's all right. I mean, you know, because that's fine. Because I've been, you know, doing my own shows for 12 years. So it's fine. Don't worry about it.
Well, yeah. But the thing is, right, if you've been doing it for 12 years, that's even more embarrassing. Yeah. Because there's two things here. First... Yeah. If you've got guests on, tell them the right time. That's the first thing you need to do. Just tell them the right time. Because I know what Gary's like. We all know what Gary's like, right? He turned up at the wrong airport once to fly to Scotland, like, and then said to us, but I had it planned out so well. No, you didn't, Gary.
He was a bit late. I didn't even think, like, not told him.
And I know what was going through your mind when you were waiting for him, right? And it wasn't pleasant. And then... turns out you were wrong and you fucked up, right? So that was
I admitted it, Dave. That's fine.
Secondly,
held my hands up.
Yeah. Timor works for one of the biggest gaming websites in certainly in England, right? I mean, the world, some might say. Yeah. Doesn't mean he can walk all over you, Sean. Whose town is this? This is our town.
What do you mean?
Well, just, I'm going at 10. All right then, mate. See you later. We don't need you then. That's how you deal with that situation. I'm just trying to teach you here. You can't let guests walk over you, even if it's Timor. You know what I mean?
Okay.
So, Timor, I know you listen to this, mate. Don't think you're getting away with that under my watch. All right, you want to go at 10? Fine. How about you go at 9, and then we carry on and do the show ourselves?
Not half nine.
Don't need you, mate. Don't need you. What was it like? Because it must have been pretty weird. We've done, what is this, episode 32? 33, it is.
32.
Yeah, what was it like? Because it's the first one I've not done. Obviously,
it was different because at the end of the day, like not only, I mean, losing the host for one thing, but losing half the normal team is obviously going to make a difference.
Yeah, because I'm not being a dickhead. Like, genuine chat now, right? I know that you guys can do a show, right? As you say, you've done one for years. Matt does his own show. I know that you can do a show, but... Mm. I think there's something weird about doing a podcast that you're so used to doing with certain people and when they're not there. I mean, it's even like that when one person's missing for a show, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like if James can't make it one meet a week or you can't make it or whatever, it's just a completely different vibe. It's weird. And that's why we're
It's like you've got to ask yourself, well, especially like hosting two very similar shows. So hosting
don't flatter
this
yourself,
one, like,
Sean. Don't flatter yourself, boy.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Being on two different shows.
Yeah.
Co-hosting two different shows. That was what I meant to say. It's like, what difference... Like, am I different on this show than I am on Midnight Resistance? Like, is that something I have to think about? Or is it just different because of the people that are on it? Or... Like, is what... That last episode, is that any different than an episode of Midnight Resistance would have been if it was the same people? Do you know what I mean?
Well, I think
I preferred you, Sean. Without David, you sounded better. I thought it was better.
I'll leave off, James. You've been serious. Fuck off, mate. No one's believing that. The person to answer that question is someone I like to call the listener. So tweet in at Computer Game Pod. Is that right, Matt?
Yeah.
tweet in and let us know if you think there's a difference between Midnight Resistance, Sean, and Computer Game Show, Sean. I think there is, but I wanted to see if anyone else has picked up on it. Sean's a lot more grumpy on Midnight Resistance. He's a lot more, fuck this, fuck everyone. It's like he's had a drink.
Whereas on this, I'm like, I'm being polite. That sounds like I'm just sitting and being like, oh, fuck, yeah. Like, can't be bothered. But, no, I don't know. I think, when you're in control, it's different, isn't it? Yeah,
Sean, can I ask you a question?
Yes.
That bit with the stock market thing, was that you that created that, or Capone?
That was me.
Okay.
Why did you not think it was Capone?
I really liked it. But it sounded like a Capone creation. It's
that was me, vocals and all.
Oh, well, okay. speaking of which, we have had a message from Capone saying that he's starting to show an interest that he might edit a show in the future. Don't worry, Capone people, we've got a plan. Trust us, we got this. Matt, was there any other feedback for last week's show?
So, just commenting on the Capone editing thing. The great thing about that is that a lot of people, I'm going to assume, don't even know who Capone is. So that's what I'm most excited about, just hearing their first reaction to Capone edit. That's going to be absolute gold.
Did we have any feedback last week?
We did. I mean, first one is from Adam Capone. 15 minutes into Computer Game Pod, and what is going on? Dave, come home. Brad Davies, a similar sentiment. Blimey, this week's Computer Game Pod is a bit of a hard listen. So,
it was that or nothing, basically. So...
Can I say what you said to us? Can I say what you said to us? Sure.
What, which bit? When?
When we got that tweet.
Capone's or?
Yeah.
Yeah, go on then.
Look, I know he's always up for a wind-up, but I'm not in the mood this morning. Just, you know what he's like, but it's still managed to pierce that thick skin.
Yeah.
Get into your...
Cammy Toman also got involved. Pretty sure Computer Game Pod are stepping on my turf for that interesting discussions jingle.
What is that?
Hang on. So that was ripped off, Sean.
No,
I've lost respect.
It was just that he came on Midnight Resistance and did a little jingle for his little pinball segment.
Oh, it's that guy.
So now he thinks he's fucking invented jingles.
Ooh, well, you might want to go back and listen to some old Joy Pods, mate. You know what I mean? Get to know you there, guess. That was a classic.
If you don't know, get to know.
What was the other ones? Farley's Game Club.
Yeah, that was brilliant. That
Michael's Hate Seller.
Yeah, that was a classic. All the classics. There's actually, if you want to go back and hear them again, bring back the memories, there's a YouTube video with all of the old Joypod jingles on it. From the best to the worst.
I used to like randomly say, if you don't know, get to get to know, like, all the time. Just because it felt good to say it.
There was some absolutely... Do you remember Dawson? Pitches? The Pitches jingle was absolutely fantastic, but the segment was absolute shit. So it was like, but we kept going because that jingle was so good. Yeah, Pitches should have died a lot sooner than it did. okay, yeah, sorry.
Luke Dawson got involved with the PC building chat, which was arguably my favourite part of last week's show. I love that.
Did you talk about building PCs?
It's Farley, you haven't even listened to the episode, mate.
I listened to the first half an hour. Just the first half an hour, and then that was enough. And then I'm glad that I didn't bother now.
You're a co-host of the show. How can you not listen to an episode? The listeners have heard more of the show than you at this point.
At least Dave... You've listened to the whole thing so he could assassinate me properly. I mean, come on.
Yeah, I mean,
I got a message from Minority Resistance co-host Chris Spann saying, like, are you actually really annoyed at Gary in this PC building? Apparently it sounded like I was.
I'm really sorry I missed that. Yeah, go on.
I love Chris. He always tries to, like, find out what the real goss is down. Do you really hate him? Yeah, actually, I do. Tweeted the next minute, blatantly.
Anyway, Luke Dawson, PC build tip. Put a PSU in first and plug in, but do not turn the plug on. This earth's the case. Thanks, Luke. That's awesome. Awesome advice.
I'm definitely going to use that when I'm building my next PC.
Yes, under a tree.
I think Bill's already started doing this, but I've not heard from him since, so probably dead.
Yeah, almost certainly dead. Yep.
Jokes aside, you missed out a couple of tweets there, right? Because there were some positives. People were saying that they really enjoyed it. They thought it had more of a Midnight Resistance vibe, but which I assume is a compliment.
Well, it's about answers the question we had earlier, I suppose. But yeah.
Yeah, good point.
I probably didn't see them because I got any Midnight Resistance mentions on mute. So
fair enough.
I'm sick of the comparisons. Too much fucking nothing. The biggest bit of follow-up, arguably, is the release of Skate 3. That's surely the biggest piece of follow-up, the global piece of follow-up.
Well, I mean, yeah, this is
the release of Skate 3, you mean it's been added to backwards compatibility? Yeah.
Well,
that's not the same as what we wanted. We wanted the HD remake. That's not the same.
Well, technically, it was in HD, so it counts, but it wasn't a remake, so maybe not. 50% there.
Because a lot of people were tweeting me about it as well, which is really cool. But also, I was like, yeah, but I'm not going to buy an Xbox just for that.
What? Because this is interesting, actually, because this was running through my head this week. Mm-hmm. Why haven't you got an Xbox, Sean?
I don't want one, Dave.
I think it's quite interesting because, like, your main form of entertainment, like, your favourite form of entertainment is gaming, right?
Yeah.
So what's holding you back getting one of the three... Like, why not an Xbox? And what have you even considered it?
I can't find enough reasons to bother. Like, most of the games I'm interested in are coming out on PC as well. So I need to stick some more RAM in the PC and then I can play, you know, Forza Horizon 3 and stuff. And that's it. Like, I've got no other reason.
You had a 360, yeah?
I've got a 360, yeah.
Yes, that makes sense. I can get why you're not that interested in the Xbox One.
Yeah, but they're not crazy expensive when you think about it. I mean, like, it's all relative, so, you know, I'm not saying... And I'm not even saying you should get one. I just find it interesting.
You're saying that, I'm bored.
No, I'm just saying that as... Like, it's, you know, gaming's such a big thing for you. I don't know. Maybe I'm coming from a really stupid perspective of, oh, you just buy everything. And I probably wouldn't own
it. It is unusual for me to be this far into a generation and not own all of them. I don't know. I've just not found enough good reasons to bother.
And I suppose that those reasons sort of fade even more now that most of the games are coming to PC anyway, right?
It's also different to how it was back in the day. What, you know, even a last generation or generation before, where there were way more exclusives. Now there's you know, there's barely any exclusives, and then also if you've got a PC, there's even less reason. So, a couple of generations ago, I'm sure Sean would have bought an Xbox, you know, one if it was available, even if the games aren't great, just because there's the odd exclusive. Now it's just very little need.
Yeah, from your perspective, what do you think I'm missing out on?
Well, it's hard to tell, really, because I don't know how things run on a PC. I don't know how... I mean, for starters, you're missing out on playing tights with me. That's the first thing. And Rainbow Six. You missed out on that a long time ago.
But I've got both those games, Dave.
Yeah, but you got them on the wrong
Just
console.
Just on a better console.
Yeah, that's true. The better console, fair. I don't know. You know what? I don't know. I suppose... it's another console, isn't it, I guess? It's hard to really sort of find a good reason to own one. I get that, but I just couldn't live without it. I couldn't get rid of my Xbox now because I've got too much to plow on it and I've got all my friends in it. And then the more these backwards compatible games come through, especially the ones that I own digitally, it makes such a difference, you know? I'd much sooner obviously get rid of my 360 than the Xbox One, despite the fact that's got Sky Sports on it, as previously mentioned. I just thought it was weird.
I don't think I'd miss my Xbox One if I got rid of it.
Yeah, well, you're not playing with us anyway. I don't know what you're playing at lately, Matt. I mean, there's been two absolutely banging first-person shooters come out, and you're sitting there with a fucking helmet on, knocking one out to fucking res. Yeah, do you think, because you're not getting a PS4 Pro, right, Sean? PS4 Pro?
I don't think so.
But not what unless. About, are you considering a Scorpion when it comes out? Scorpio, whatever it's
Scorpio.
Called?
I don't think so, no. I mean, I guess the only thing it would take is if it turned out the Scorpio's the proper new one, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if that was, like, definitely capable thing of things that, like, my PC couldn't do without a massive overhaul, then maybe that'll be more cost effective.
When's the last time you upgraded your PC?
2 years ago.
So how long do you reckon you got genuinely until you feel that?
I don't know, because I know it needs more RAM, but it always needed more RAM. I've just, nothing's come up that like refuses to run until Forza Horizon 3, which like literally you try and load it up and it's just like, you're not even trying it, mate. Fuck off. But then it's only like 30 quid for another 4 gig of RAM. So I guess if I stick that in and just see how I go, probably only a few more years though. So yeah, so there's a good chance that the Scorpio will be more cost effective than basically starting a new PC.
It's going to be interesting to see how that... I mean, I genuinely think that Xbox have quite a good opportunity to come out swinging with the Scorpio next year. Yeah, it's going
to
be...
It's weird. Like, it's interesting seeing... Like, there's all articles saying, oh, that's for, like, the last 4 months Xbox has been selling more and it's doing really well again.
It's because everyone's got PlayStation.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Like, is that not just because, like, loads of people who've already bought PS4s are like, yeah, fuck it, let's may as well get an Xbox now.
Yeah, I suppose. I'd like to see what the equivalent was between the 360 and PS3 3 years into their lives.
Yeah, you see, that was interesting because I felt like there was a swing from the 360 to the PS3 sort of later on, but then that might just be me and my friends.
I know it did. It really caught up towards the end, didn't it? Especially with I think what helped with that was it having a Blu-ray player, and towards the end of the generation, I'd say there was obviously there was far more HD TVs out there than there was at the start, and the opportunity to get a cheap Blu-ray player out of it as well was an attraction. I can't see what the attraction is for these ones.
Plus, Last Guardian for the PS3, guys. Come on.
Oh, yep, it's coming out.
That was enticing, wasn't it?
Totally for the PS3, we promise.
I will say another thing about the PS4 and Xbox figures is that a lot of people, you know, were waiting for the Pro, or, you know, maybe waiting for other deals. So,
yeah.
But it's just certainly interesting.
Do you think there's a similar market? Because I know a lot of people getting PS4s, like people getting kids PS4s for Christmas. And they're just not interested in a Pro. Like,
no, of course not.
The PS4 is at a certain price now that they're happy to jump on, and the Pro is just an expensive console again.
I actually had earlier this evening the joy of explaining to a friend who doesn't really play games what the PS4 Pro is.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Go on, Sean, let's hear it.
Well, basically, she was just like, look, I want to get my boyfriend a PS4 for Christmas. You know, what do I get? What games, etc. And I was like, right, the thing is, there's sort of two of them now. But one of them's better, slightly, but only if you've got a really good TV. Do you know what TV you've got? And she's like, I'm not sure if it's HD. Right.
Oh, God.
Okay, probably don't bother with the new one then.
Yeah, but my wife would give the exact same answer to that.
No, like I sort of said, well, it will be HD. Don't worry about that, but it's definitely not going to be 4K. So, I mean, I know people have said there are benefits, even if you don't have a 4K TV, but I don't know.
Well, we'll find out what the real benefits are soon. But first, we've got a little bit of news, haven't we, James?
Yeah, I didn't post this, so no. I'm not taking responsibility.
He's scared to do the news now.
Well, I'm perfectly happy to talk about this. So I was going to give James a break this week, but it turns out they didn't even post it up. So his terrible run of form for the news is continuing at the moment. Who posted this then? Was this you, Sean?
It was me, yeah.
Okay, let's go. What's the news?
Right, so there has been... I don't know if this was a leak. I mean, it's come from Laura Dale, who's been pretty reliable with stuff she leaked about the Switch prior to its unveiling. So I'm inclined to believe this, but apparently Game are going to be charging £200 or £199.99 for the Switch, but that's for like a basic model. And then there's going to be a £250 one, which apparently comes with a game and more internal storage. No idea what the game is though.
It doesn't really add up, does it?
That sounds similar to one of my predictions, but go on.
It doesn't really add up, though. I mean, having a £199 SKU for a basic model, then getting additional storage and a game for just an extra £50, does that sound right to you?
Depends like, on the game, I suppose. What was the difference
between the Wii U, like the basic one and the other one?
Wasn't it £70?
Yeah, and that was just extra storage, wasn't it? And there was some like weird thing. If you got the pro one, there were like discounts on the
There was 10% off DLC and stuff.
Yeah, I never felt like that materialized.
It came with a charging dock. And
Was that not in the basic one? Okay.
It wasn't in the basic one though, because I didn't get one with mine.
The thing with the Wii U was that even the pro one, like the storage was still pathetic in the long run. So, you know, later on when they were really going cheap, but it was just the white one, people were like, oh yeah, but do I need the pro one? I was like, mate, you'd be plugging in a USB hard drive in either way, so don't worry about it.
So what do we think? If that price point is legit, Nintendo have won gaming, I think.
It's a really brilliant price if they're going to release it at that price.
I mean, we all suggested sort of 300-ish, didn't we?
Yeah.
Well, that's what I was thinking. I mean, looking at the console itself, I mean, it sounds stupid, but looking at it, it doesn't look like a cheap piece of kit. Like, you look at the Wii U, and you're kind of like, wow, where's my money going? Because it's all plastic and, you know, the screen itself isn't glass. It's this that weird plastic
stuff. I mean, I suppose, like, obviously people are comparing it to other consoles, but I guess we should be looking at sort of phone and tablet.
Yeah, definitely. If think about those Kindles where you can buy like six of them in a box or whatever for like 200 quid.
But then you're hoping that it can run better games than the Kindle Fire.
Yeah,
I mean,
if you're comparing it, you would think it would have a similar amount of power to a high-end smartphone, which you're looking at like what, 600 or 700 quid, and that, you know, that difference in price is not just the radio in it that allows it to be a telephone. So I don't know. I mean, I hope this is real,
but we'll have to wait and see. It's going to be, again, next year. I mean, this year has turned out to be a pretty incredible year for gaming, especially towards the end. I mean, it's got its plus points, it's got its benefits, it's also got it's also has a problem with the end of the year being loaded with so much quality. It's been hard to sort of keep up, and I'm inevitably missing out on some cracking games apparently that I'm going to have to catch up on next year.
We talked about, so the obviously the whole PSVR weekend we did, and you know, we said we're going to try and do the same for the Switch.
Yeah.
Does that mean we're all going to have our switches sent to whoever's house we're doing that?
Well, it depends on the launch,
because if we're doing
date,
that on the weekend, and if it comes out on the Friday, like half of us are going to be like waiting for the parcel to arrive before they can set off.
I see Matt there just signing for like four switches.
Best day ever.
I don't know. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it. I think what we're going to have to do is hire out a basketball court. No doubt.
Yes.
We'll get that sorted.
Little
gag. Okay, cool. I think we should probably start with Matt this week, because Matt has bought a PS4 Pro. Last week we all heard him saying, well, I might not keep it. I tutted and rolled my eyes at that, Matt, if I'm totally honest. You bought one. What did you make of it?
I'm a professional PlayStation 4 player.
So starting off, what was the transfer like from your old PS4 to the new one? How did you?
It just took 8 hours.
Really?
I didn't have to. I could basically just go to the old one and then re-download all my stuff. But if you plug an Ethernet cable in between the two consoles, you can select where you transfer, but essentially you can transfer everything. So the new PlayStation is now just like my old one. But it took 8 hours, so that was a bit of a blow.
Right? Because when you do that with your phone, you do that with your phone almost every year, and it takes, what, 20 minutes?
Yeah, but I had like a terabyte. It's a little bit different.
You had a full up hard drive?
No. I think I probably like 700 gig or whatever. So it's obviously different. It's more on the phone. But although to be fair, I think maybe I like a dodgy Ethernet cable, because loads of people I was reading, they had like 2 or 3 hour transfers and they probably about the same. So who knows? It probably won't take long for everyone, but it took a fair length of time for me.
So what are your initial impressions of the console? What are the benefits of owning one?
Well, I haven't got 4K HDR TV, already I'm not seeing the full benefit. But and for me, the benefits were really, really just about PSVR. And for me, I'm well happy with what it's done. I played So I played a couple of games before the before I got the Pro, and I've played the same game since. I've definitely noticed an improvement. I've heard countless, I've watched our videos and seen pictures of other people who have compared other games, saying there's quite a big difference. So for me, I'm totally happy with it. I think the console looks great as well. It is super fast. It's almost easier to go down into a folder and it loads instantly, and go into like your friends list and it loads instantly, and all that sort of stuff. It just makes a big difference. Sure, a lot of people could say maybe it's not worth £350, but it's just so much more snappier. So
when you say you've noticed the difference in the games, like what have you noticed, and how obvious is the difference there? I mean, try and look at this, like try and step back from someone that's just paid a lot of money for a new console. Is it that noticeable between the two?
I think it really is on Robinson, the journey, which I'll talk about a bit later. Others, not at all. I haven't actually played Rez yet. A lot of people say it's a big thing there. But this whole thing, I think it's really, really subjective. So some people won't notice it at all. I mean, some people have difficulty discerning between like 720p and 1080p, and yeah. Other people have even said that they can't even notice if it's 4K or not. So this is really subjective. And a lot of people are talking about changes and improvements to games which haven't even been patched, you know.
they get caught
up. I was listening to another podcast and they just said, can't see any difference at all, like with this. But like you said, maybe it is just subjective, I guess.
Yeah, on Robinson the Journey, I've definitely noticed a difference. Like it feels like that game's got more foliage, and Crytek have said that they've done loads to improve sort of texture detail and stuff. And that's one of the games I've made sure I played for like 20 minutes before on the night before, and I did a transfer. But then the following night, I then played it on Pro, and it definitely felt much more detailed, a lot less blurry, which is the main thing. Yeah, so for me, I really only bought it for PSVR improvements already. I'm happy with that. I can't wait to get like a decent TV and see even more improvements in terms of 4K HDR and stuff.
Have you tested it out with non-VR games?
I haven't played a non-VR game since I got a PSVR, so no.
Wow, really?
I've had a lot of stuff to review, yeah. I just have not played a non-VR game. I'm looking forward to it, but I've still got loads to get through, so no, not yet.
It's been quite funny because I checked Spawn today, and Matt had about God knows how many reviews he had to write for PSVR, and they went from, 2,000-word detailed reviews on games to just a rundown now. That's the latest article.
That's what it's got to.
Here's 14 games. Here's what I think of these 14 games. Goodbye.
I've got four left to go, so I'm nearing the end of my journey. So PS4 Pro, it's probably not worth it, but I'm glad I've got it, and I feel like I'm future proof now, so for the next 2 years at least. And yeah, I'm well happy. I think it looks class. I think the console as well looks great. It's
do you think, because that was one of the things I thought looked really weird.
I think it was really nice. It's a lot bigger actually than the, so I didn't have the slim, I had the matte version of I had the 1 TB matte version of the PS4. It's a lot deeper than that. It's a fair bit bigger, which I wasn't really expecting. I think it looks class. It's a lot quieter. The pads have got that touch bar. It's got the light in the touch pad now, which still feels really super pointless. I don't quite know what that's even about, but it's nice, I guess, seeing a blue light at the top of the pad. I mean, it's not worth £350, but it is what it is. But I'm glad I've got it. I'm super glad I've got it, because I feel like, now when I get my new TV next year, I have an awesome machine to play it on. And I feel like I'm sort of don't have to buy anything else PlayStation for a long time now. I've got the VR headset. I've got the 4K, HDR sort of gaming console. So yeah, I'm happy. And I really feel like in terms of games being updated and taken advantage of this, this is obviously super early doors. And I feel like in 6 months' time, the games that were built with Pro in mind are going to look really, really fantastic. I haven't even played any non-VR games to even compare them, because there's also improvements to games. Just standard games that have been updated to make use of Pro. So even games you don't have to play in 4K, just the games that have been basically downscaled, I think they're calling it, from a 4K sort of signal into 1080p, them games are also looking much improved. So I haven't even tried that myself yet.
Can I just say, because I know that I know what our listeners are thinking, and and it says it sounds like you're not completely... Like, you don't see it as not that you're disappointed, but you don't seem as hyped up as I thought you would be over this thing.
Well, it's still a PS4. I mean, it's not a new console. It's just, it's a slightly improved PS4. I mean, I never felt that sort of new console excitement. I was like, oh, it tried to get it into what it's like, but it's not like getting a Switch or...
It's a bit like when I got the new 3DS, it's kind of the same sort of thing.
It's still a PS4. It looks exactly the same. I mean, it's in terms of like the UI and, you know, I literally sort of transferred my old PS4 into a new one. So there's no change. I mean, like, the pad's nice because it's a newer pad. I feel like the VR games I've played look better, but that could be a placebo effect. Yeah, I'm certainly not... But, yeah, it's not blowing my mind. I think if I had like a new TV at the same time, maybe it'd be another level, another step up. But I don't have that, so yeah, it's.
So if I was to ask you, right? Look, I'm thinking because I've got 4K TV, and I know you've not seen the effects of that or whatever. But if I was to say, look, I can't really afford a PS4 Pro, but if I really pushed and scraped something together, I might be able to get one. Would you recommend it or no?
I don't know. I mean, another thing I'll say, I basically sold my PS4 for 140 quid. So I bought the PS4 Pro with Dishonored 2. And I sold that today for like 32 quid. And I got like, so basically in the end, I think the consoles cost about £180. So for that, if you can sell yours and sell some games to cover most of the costs, I would say you should probably do it because it'd be awesome, you know, to play 4K games and stuff, especially with TV you've got. I reckon, hell yeah, for 200 quid. I mean, paying a full 350, you know, without potentially selling stuff to cover the cost and selling your old console, I'm not so sure, but, you know, whatever. I'm happy just the PSVR improvements, frankly.
Do I look to go for this or do I, you know, look to the future for the Scorpio? Like that's the other thing.
I mean, if it's a choice for them two, then you've already got PS4, so I would just put them on into Scorpio, definitely. I mean, I obviously will want to get my name and the Switch as well, but I don't know. I mean, if it is like this or the Scorpio, then I would almost certainly just put your money towards Scorpio because you've already got PS4 and it's just a supercharged PS4, as the advertising goes.
Yeah.
I think if you had a PSVR, I think that's a something else to add on. And yeah, because there are definite improvements for that.
Oh, this but is a question. Then, would you recommend people get PSVR or the PS4 Pro?
Oh, PSVR, definitely.
Right.
Yeah, without a shadow of a doubt. Yeah, if you've only got one lot of £350 to spend on PlayStation stuff this Christmas, and maybe that should have been me, but if you're that person, yeah, I'll absolutely get a PSVR without a shadow of a doubt.
Interesting.
Yeah. But I would love to see this on an amazing TV set and see what's like. Evan says obviously it looks incredible on Battlefield and Titans and stuff. It all look amazing. Obviously, I don't really have that, so I can't see that. But yeah,
see, because that's the thing. I'm thinking that like before
you got the TV, haven't you? That's the thing. Yeah.
Well, this week I was genuinely thinking if I sell all my 360 and all the games that I got with it, then I could probably scrape enough money to cover the costs and get one.
You get about 50 quid. Move on.
And sell your old PS4, of course.
Yeah, and sell my old PS4. But now, after hearing you talk about it, I'm kind of thinking, well, actually, maybe I should just leave it for when my current PS4 breaks. And obviously, if my current PS4 breaks and I need a new one, then I'll be going pro. I won't be getting the standard one. I'll get the new one. It's just, it kind of feels like that should be more of a replacement thing because it'll be slightly cheaper by the time that happens. And, you know, I don't know. And you've kind of talked me out.
I got a bonus from work. And you know as well as I do, Dave, if some money comes into my account, it's a race against time to get it spent before it gets spent on like wallpaper or sofa. Right. So basically, I had a very, very small window. At one point, I thought, I'm not even bothered, but I've pretty much got to get it now, otherwise I won't get it, and that 350 will go on a fucking carpet somewhere. So I had to make a move there and then.
Yeah, it was the same for me and the Wii U a couple of years ago. It's kind of like I have to get one now, otherwise I will never own one. It's as simple as that.
Yeah. I was perfectly happy with my old PS4 and I haven't got a TV, like I said, but you know, it is what it is.
Cool. All right. So, what was the game that you've been playing? What is this?
So, I'm playing Robinson: The Journey, which is a PSVR game. Yeah, I will get to play some non-VR game soon. In fact, like I said, I had Dishonored 2 that came on the console, and I did want to play that, but everyone who I talked to about it said that I should probably play the first one first because I miss out on loads of the lore and stuff, so I just sold it, even though really? Today it's actually got loads of amazing review scores.
Who's everyone? Who told you that?
I was reading people on Roll Mark was saying that I'll get a lot more out of it if I knew the story behind things, and I might be missing out on it.
Probably just watch a recap, to be honest.
Yeah, I don't remember it being like really detailed or anything like that. It's not like, I don't know.
Well, it's sold anyway now, so it is what it is.
Well, you should have asked us, really, shouldn't you?
Yeah. But I haven't said that. Dishonored 2 has got some really great review scores today. So
it's been off the charts, hasn't it? People are naming it for Game of the Year already. They're saying, you know... I've seen a lot.
Say already, it is November Day.
No, well, yeah, still the Last Guardian, Sean. You're forgetting about that classic. Mm. That's got gold. I was a little bit surprised actually because there was a lot of, you know, there was that whole Bethesda thing. I think that gave that game a little bit of a bad press before it come out.
I think it's definitely suffered. I mean, it hasn't suffered in terms of critically, but I think there was basically no hype for that game whatsoever, it felt like. There probably are in certain circles, but I'm not sure if it's a Bethesda thing or what, but it felt like nothing happened, and now like reviews are sort of, you know, coming out, and obviously it's looking great, but yeah.
It
sold really poorly.
I think 30% down on the first one, and I think that's definitely down to, like, you know, if there's no day one reviews, I think that's going to absolutely affect whether people want to put a hand in the pocket and buy one.
Isn't it also just another... at the moment it's really crowded, isn't it? There's so many games that have come out recently that are like first person as well.
Well, this is it, and I've thought about this a lot because I've reviewed a lot of games recently, and the last three games I've played and spoken about in public, I've been like, you need to own this. It's kind of like, it's getting a little bit, and I find it a bit embarrassing because I'm saying, you need to own this, and people saying, oh, okay, I bought it because I heard you on the podcast raving about it, and then the next week I'll go, forget that one, you need to own this. But it's genuinely how I felt. I mean, every game I've played towards the end of this year have been like absolutely incredible, and we'll get to it a little bit later, but you know, for a game that like Battlefield 1 that I was raving about and still stand by, I still think is an absolutely incredible game. I've not even touched it for 2 weeks. You know, well, I have, tell a lie, I've played a couple of rounds, but I've not played it that much. There's just so much. So when it comes to a game like Dishonored, which was a bit of a, not, I wouldn't say cult hit when the first game came out, but it was certainly not seen as a AAA game before launch. Not in the, you know, in the huge, in the
not
grand
Call
scheme
of Duty,
of things.
Basically. No, it's not, no, like, yeah.
So that maybe that one's just slipped through the net, which is a shame because it's not the only one. Again, we'll get to that. Right. So anyway, back to the Robinson Crusoe.
Robinson: The Journey. So it's a first-person, I guess, walking simulator adventure game for PSVR. You take the play. You are this kid called Robin as a child, and in there's a cutscene when the game starts, and basically you crash land on this weird, strange alien planet which has loads of dinosaurs and stuff on it. Basically, you start off and you're in your little sort of your little pod thing. It's you and it's a floating robot companion. Yet another one. This one's called Higgs, and Higgs basically follows you around the game, the different areas within the game, and tells you things like objectives and what to do. But essentially, it's a walking simulator with some puzzles. I think straight away it looks really, really fantastic, and obviously now I'm playing on pro, but even before I was playing on pro, I think it's definitely one of the strongest looking PSVR games out there. I mean, Batman's incredibly detailed, but I feel like this is detailed, but it's also quite expansive. It's probably the first proper world that I've experienced in PSVR. I mean, Russia Blood's got a really, really strong place, sort of sense of place, but that was obviously an on-rail shooter. Batman was really great, but the play areas were quite limited. But this is like the first full game, at least the ones I played, the first full sort of proper adventure game that actually I feel like it could do really, really well without the novelty of VR. I feel like this isn't a game which just, it's really great because it's in VR. I think it'd be good actually without VR. So graphically looks good, but in terms of gameplay, you walk around this sort of jungle island environment. There are animals and stuff which you can scan, which is actually a way more fun than say No Man's Sky. Unlike No Man's Sky, you don't just press a button, you use your controller to essentially you hold down the button and you use your head to move a crosshair, a reticule, and on each animal you can scan, there's loads of green dots. You basically have to move your head around to hit all the green dots. If you hit a red dot, which is also floating around this animal, you have to sort of scan it again. But that's like a really simple mechanic, but even that's quite fun, just to scan animals rather than just looking at an animal and holding down triangle or whatever they did in No Man's Sky.
Yeah.
So you can scan animals and you can add them to your sort of your big sort of compendium again, just like No Man's Sky. But there were puzzles involving climbing. This uses the same climbing mechanics as Crytek's other game called The Climb, which is an Oculus Touch game. When you come up to like a rock face that you can climb or a ladder or something, your two hands come out in front of you and you can use L1 and L2 to L1 and R1, sorry, to climb up and down. Rock faces and ladders and whatnot to reach other areas. The control system, it only really uses the DualShock, which is strange. If any of you have seen a screenshot of this, it looks like Robin the child, the kid you control, it looks like he's holding a Move controller, but there's no Move controller support.
Do you reckon that was yanked out then?
Well, no, because it looks like it should absolutely have it, but then in terms of like movement, obviously move controls don't have a stick or anything, so it makes sense for it not to be move controlled, because I'm not sure how you would control
that in there to make you.
Yeah, it's super strange. Everyone's assumed they were going to have move controls, but because it essentially is a first person. It's first person controls. Yeah, a move controller wouldn't really work. But it's so super strange. Yeah, because it would work really well with climbing. It would work well because, again, the thing your character's controlling, it looks like a move controller. There's lots of scanning the environment. There's lots of other things using this device you've got. So it looks like it makes sense to move controls, but it doesn't. It's just sort of standard DualShock controls. The controls themselves, your standard sort of stuff. You use a left stick to walk around. Go forward and back, and right stick to move around to rotate. This game has made me feel quite sick at times. I mean,
when we played the Oculus EGX, there was that sort of haunted house thing that we tried out. Do you remember?
Yeah.
And you had a real problem with moving with first person controls, but also using a headset at the same time. Is it? I assume it's the same sort of feeling here.
Yes, I mean this locomotion problem is just a general problem in VR. Trying to work out how you do movement and locomotion in VR games without making the player sick is still a challenge that people are trying to work out. I mean, how Robinson does it is so I've actually changed my controls to I've turned all the comfort controls off, which is probably what's making me sick. But essentially, you can have it so the right stick rotates you at a sort of 25 degree angle, so it sort of turns you around that way. I've turned those off and turned it onto smooth mode.
What does that mean? Rotate at a 25 degree angle.
So when you press right, as opposed to you just like naturally spinning round as you would do normally, this sort of takes you like little sections around, and that's supposed to reduce sickness, as opposed it would sort of almost click round to different angles. So yeah, I'm not sure what angle.
That's mad, isn't it? Because one of the things that these VR games have kind of picked up on, and it seems to be more and more, is that teleporting feels more natural than actually moving around smoothly, right? Like, you look at Rec Room, they were saying that the Giant Bomb guys, when they were playing Rec Room, they were saying, actually, teleporting feels all right, it doesn't make me feel sick at all. But
that sort of makes sense, though, doesn't it? Because there's no movement. You know, like we were saying on the last episode that was really good that James didn't listen to. it's that the thing that gives you the motion sickness most of the time is because that mismatch between like you can see one thing but you can feel another. In this case, you can see movement but you can't feel it.
Yeah.
So if you're just jumping around from point to point, that's probably much less likely to trigger Motion sickness.
That's crazy, though, because I wouldn't have thought that. Like, if I was in a room and someone suggested that, I'd kind of think, well, no, surely it's just going to disorientate you so much more, being in one position and then just flicking over to another. Do you know what I mean? But I guess
I turn it off because it was starting to annoy me, you know, because I would find myself going up to an object and, you know, pressing with the right stick to turn right, and I would maybe move slightly too much of an angle. I was like trying to have to line myself up a lot, and it just felt weird. So I turned all those modes off, and now I'm just using regular first person controls. But that is definitely making me unwell. I mean, I'm usually given the first half hour or so, and then I sort of start feeling a bit woozy, and I take the headset off, which is annoying because I feel like. Well, I'm starting to get sick when I am basically forgetting that I'm in VR and I'm playing like a normal first person like sort of adventure game, and then I suddenly do like some jumps and some climbs, and I'm bombing all over the place. I'm looking around everywhere with my head, and I think that's where it's starting to make me feel a little bit unwell. But this is something I'm just going to hopefully get used to, and hopefully in a few days I'll be totally fine with it. But so controls are also really 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 finicky, to the point actually where one of the face buttons, the triangle button, is just to bring up controls. Which is it feels bonkers that wouldn't be in a settings menu, but it's actually just on one of the face buttons. It just brings up a little thing in front of you to show you the controls. Right. But you can basically press L1 and R1 to like flick, change what your little tool does. You can use it to scan items. We can also use it to levitate items. And yeah, anyway, but it controls a little bit finicky. But apart from that, it's fine. It does some really, really cool stuff. So Higgs is your floating robot companion, but you can look at him and press a button and go into Higgs mode, which is basically when it goes in almost like a tilt shift style view, where you're above the local environment, and it almost like looking down at the environment like a model train set. And you can see your character, you can see, you know, you're above the trees, you can see other elements. You can use that to sort of solve puzzles. There's a lot of these puzzles where you have to basically these power gates where you see like a pylon on the map, and that's giving out a certain amount of electricity, and you basically have to hit these buttons to move electricity basically around the island to open different gates and get certain machines to work. But it's really cool suddenly going to this view above the map to change that stuff. One of the big issues with this game is that it's only like 3 or 4 hours long,
right?
Which I thought would be an issue for me, but after getting sick after half an hour, it's actually taken me longer than I thought it would to actually finish the game. I've sort of thought about it differently this week. I mean, last week I said, I think I might have said last week on the show, you know, about the whole, I can't believe they charged 25 quid for Super Hypercube. It's crazy. If that was a tenner, it would sell like gangbusters. But, you know, I've come to realize, obviously, you know, Sony hasn't released sales figures for PSVR. I don't know how many there are, but it's obviously quite a niche product at the moment. So, and devs need to bet their money. Like they can't just say, oh, let's just sell it for 10 and hope we sell enough. Like that, these developers and publishers are saying, look, we've got to sell it at 40 or 50 quid. You know, because if we get, you know, only this amount of sales, then hopefully we've covered our costs and we can develop another VR game in the future. So I was probably a little bit naive and wasn't really thinking about the
yeah,
the big picture.
I know what you're saying there. Like, and they certainly know the business better than we do. But at the same time, I mean, when you're seeing a game's tanking and the reason for that is the high price point, you've got to then do the maths the same.
Well, yeah, but it might not just be about that. And you know, if you're a PSVR owner now, then you're an early adopter and you want basically VR to succeed. Otherwise, you probably wouldn't have bought one. And so I know it's a bit different because you know we've just got review code, so I haven't actually bought a lot of these games I'm talking about. So it's different for me. And if you had 40 or 50 quid to buy one game this month or next couple of months and you bought this, you might feel a bit hard done by because it's not going to last you, you know, weeks and weeks. But yeah, it's tough at the moment because there's not many PSVR games out and people need the money so they can see that there is a desire to develop other games. So it's tough. So I don't feel quite so bad when someone's charging, say like 25 or 30 or 40 quid for a game. I mean, this game is actually 55 quid, I think, on Amazon, which is ridiculous anyway. Even more so when you think it's going to go like 4 or 5. I mean, it may have gone down, but at one point it's like 55 quid on Amazon.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I mean, it's even tougher when you think it's got like a 3 or 4 hour campaign anyway. I think there's plenty of reasons to go back in, you know, you scan other animals and you can explore and whatnot. But I'm not sure the best bit about it is just is seeing these like massive hundred, I don't know how many hundreds of feet, but this massive, massive dinosaurs, you know, in this environment is really stunning. It does really take your breath away. It's just it's cool to be in this environment anyway, but when you see one of those, you know, when a dinosaur come into view, or you come out of a cave and what you think is the end of a cave is actually like the two huge hulking legs of this massive dinosaur, it really is incredible. In fact, to the point where I saw this amazing dinosaur, I was just like, you know, agog looking up at it, and I walked forward and walked off a cliff. And I feel like I'll be there. Another time I kept walking and I was suddenly in this this swamp and this like bog, and I also died out. I feel like if I was in a film, I would just be like, dinosaur, whoa, and then dead, because I was too busy looking at the dinosaur.
Didn't that freak you out, just walking off the cliff in VR though?
It did a bit, yeah. But my stomach didn't go. That's definitely immersion breaking, to say the least. But no, I think I haven't finished Robinson yet because, you know, I've been feeling well. But it feels like the first proper world, and like it feels a really interesting world to be a part of. And this feels like the first proper game that doesn't necessarily rely on VR. I think it's definitely built with VR in mind, and that's great. But I feel like this game would be fun even without VR. One last thing, I'll stop talking about VR in a second. But one of the great things about this is because of the limitations of VR right now, they can't just, you know, throw in hundreds of enemies and, you know, for you to shoot. And I feel like if this was a non-VR game, I would have already had to shoot like 500 men. Like I know I would have done. Whereas it's actually good. Like the limitations of VR mean that
whoa. That sounds like you're such an apologist there. It's actually good that you can only get a few people on screen at one time.
No, because I've said talking about Uncharted games, I really like them, but it's like when you have to start shooting millions of guys, it's just annoying. And I wish the Uncharted games are much more about the exploration and the puzzles rather than having to shoot a billion dudes. And because of limitations of VR, it means they can't put all those enemies in. And right now, it's creating a game which I much, much prefer. It's much more of a relaxing experience. It doesn't involve having to shoot.
I totally understand what you're saying, but at the same time, come on, Matt. after playing many games where they are so limited with how much they can fit on the screen at one time, you know, technically, you're going to get a little bit tired of that. You want that a little bit different. Maybe with loads of enemies that you can shoot, because we all know it's more fun.
Yeah, isn't it? I mean, for me, it's just nice not having to worry about, oh fuck, I'm gonna see loads of crates on the floor in a minute. I'm gonna have to duck behind cover and stuff. It's just nice knowing that was not going to be a part. It's just going to be like, you know, looking at the environment, enjoying the environment, doing some puzzles and this, that, and the other. And some climbing. There's no chance of suddenly having to duck behind cover and shoot loads of guys.
We totally broke you with that challenge, didn't we? You want to play anything that isn't Uncharted right now. Which, funnily enough, have you heard about the suggestion, genuine suggestion, for Matt's next stream? New catching up, Sean?
No, I haven't, no.
What game is coming out early next year that we're all very excited about?
Wait, hang on.
Think, have a little think.
You're not talking about Nier Automata, are you?
I'm not. I've never even heard of that.
This is Mass Effect.
Yes.
God, is that early next year? Fuck me.
So what are we thinking?
You're going to do Mass Effect Marathon?
All three Mass Effect games before that one comes out.
Do it.
That would be good. That would be good, especially because one of those games is about the length of Uncharted 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah, but I wouldn't have to do a whole lot in 3 weeks, unlike that. So
you'll have more time to do it.
I don't know. I just thought, seeing as they're all on EA Access now, it'd be a good one to do, but I've got plenty of other things. So I'll sort of talk about VR in a second, but I did play Trackmania VR. There's a demo out on
the... Shit, how did you get on with that?
It was fun, actually. Yeah, it's really, really good fun. So there's a demo, a free demo on PSN. But you can also obviously buy Trackmania itself. It's been updated to include 40 VR tracks. But the devs are working to make sure every track currently in the game will be VR enabled.
God, that'd be
right. So I didn't realize it was only certain tracks.
I can't imagine being in VR in Sean's shitty forest that he made for our Trackmania challenge.
No, that'd be easier because you'd have the depth perception instead of just being, what the fuck is going on?
The fucking robe was hidden behind trees.
It was a good track.
The only issue with demo, and I haven't played the full game, and this might be issue with that as well, because the tracks are over in like 30 seconds or so. Like they're super short point to point. But in the demo, at least, there's one with a massive, massive drop, and it really does make your stomach go. It's really, but it's exciting. I didn't feel unwell. It was just really exciting to, you know, drive off the cliff and go, whoa, you know, you're bombing down the ground 100 million miles an hour. It's great fun.
I love that GIF where someone was obviously streaming them playing Trackmania VR, and you see the first jump. They hit the first jump, and then you see like the sort of camera tilt slightly to the left, and you think, what's going on here? And then the car stops moving, and the sort of, it looks like they've tilted their head as far over to the left as possible. And then you realize that actually the first jump made them take their headset off and just leave it on the side.
Yes.
Give up. Okay, cool. Who's there? Who wants to go next? James, do you want to go?
Yeah, I don't mind. Because, I mean, I've been playing two things, but I'll probably just start with Call of Duty. What do you think?
Right, so you've been playing the third of the trifecta of first-person shooter games out in fall of 2016. What do you make of it? I've heard mixed things, man.
Well, you see, I've got mixed feelings about it as well, because, I mean, I haven't played the multiplayer or the zombies and all the other stuff, because this game comes with a lot of stuff. Like, there's you know, loads of options and loads of things to do. But, I don't know,
all
I mean,
the
I finished...
The,
yeah, all the options. It's I finished the campaign, although I did bump it back down to normal, because normally I play them on hardened, but it was just irritating me too much, and I couldn't be bothered, and I found it was more enjoyable in, you know, just... in normal mode.
Yeah.
But it's a bit weird because, I mean, I played Black Ops 3 last year, and this feels so similar to Infinite Warfare in, you know, to Black Ops 3 in so many ways. And it really feels like, I mean, they've now got, how many different franchises have they got now out of Call of Duty? There's like,
well, when you
Black
think,
Ops.
Right. You can't include Modern Warfare is done now, right? Is that right?
Is it?
Yeah, I don't think they're doing any more of that. They will. They'll bring it back, no doubt. So, I mean, it depends what your criteria is. Because do you like consider World at War to be in that?
Well, that again, that's another dead one, isn't it? Because I haven't done anything with that for ages. But I know. But I mean, every year they got something coming out, and it seems that there are like two studios going. So
there's three actually, isn't there? No,
I don't know.
Oh,
is
this
it three?
Great bit of research.
Yeah. It's great, isn't it? But either way, the problem is if they're going to do that, they really need to differentiate them better, because this feels so much like Black Ops 3. Like it's again, it's futuristic, but it was really clear that when they started this was supposed to be like a new direction, like another sort of sub franchise of like Call of Duty. Mm. And because it's so similar to Black Ops 3, it doesn't really feel like that. And there's so much about the game that just feels like I'm playing the same game from last year. Like it's especially like things like weapons and everything, which really feel so similar. And there's so much they could have done with like a future setting that they kind of don't. Yeah, you know, they sort of, I mean, my overall problem with the game is the fact that they introduce really interesting ideas. Like there's like space combat in this, which I don't think they've like done before, but they never go far enough with it. It's always, they still stay within like the sort of the COD mechanics for everything, which kind of sort of ruins things a little bit, because there are some interesting ideas. I mean, the space combat's really fun. It's really, really good.
So when
it's
you say space combat, what are you talking? Is it vehicles or is it normal first person shooting?
No, this is like spaceships. Like you're actually flying like spaceships. And
how much do they let you loose with that? Because I know that they've done flying stuff in the past where you're literally just pressing forward rather than controlling fully 3D.
No, it's fully 3D, like within like the environment that you're in. So, I mean, one of the other things that they've added to this, which is kind of good, is that the game has side missions now. So what happens is you're on like the bridge of a ship, like, you know, a spaceship in space, as it were, and you can choose whether you want to go with the main story or whether you want to do side missions. The purpose, it seems, of the side missions is then obviously you get perks that then, you know, increase your power, and then when you do the main quest it would be kind of easier. But the side missions are kind of interesting because they're kind of mixed up between sort of attacking like ships whereby you like fly in and then you sort of take out like sort of fighter escorts and everything, and then you land on the ship, and then you enter the ship, like, and then it goes into like first person shooter mode, and then you have to do something, you know, like destroy like a weapons cache or something like that. But then there's other ones which are just purely just space combat. It's just you're flying in space, sort of shooting down things, and it works really well. Like it's really, really fun. I mean, I enjoyed that really more than the main story, actually. It was it's so well executed. I mean, the only thing that's kind of a shame about it is the fact that the ship doesn't have like any, there's no like 3D map or anything, so you can't see like, you know, where the enemy is or anything like that. You have to rely on these on like markers on the screen for like where you're being shot at from and things like that. But I know it's that's really good. But the main game is still just really Call of Duty, which if you like that, you know, obviously that's fine. But they really could have done more. I mean, it actually feels like Black Ops 3, they did more, like with sort of extending it than they did with this. Like, you know, obviously in Titanfall, you've got much better sort of ability to sort of, you know, to traverse the environment, yeah?
Yeah.
Like you can really like sort of do wall running and stuff like that. In this, you know, they have stuff like wall running, but only where you're allowed to. You know, it really feels like it's sort of on rails, you know, that kind of side of things. And I know, I mean, the other thing that I really did like about it is they really nailed the characters in this game, because this is the first Call of Duty game I've played probably ever where I've actually begun to care about the characters in it.
Wow.
Because they're really good. No,
seriously,
they're actually quite good. There's a couple of characters in it. I mean, particularly there's one character which is like a robot, you know, sort of soldier, but they really nailed him. He's really good. Like really, I didn't hate him. You know, I was like playing the game and I just thought this is really like, I'm really liking this character and I want to see where they go with this. But the story, I see they've really put a lot of effort into this story, like, because they've got, you know, like proper actors, they've got the whole thing going on. They've got Jon Snow from Game of Thrones as like the main like sort of villain. And
Lewis Hamilton's in it, isn't he? Conor McGregor.
Is that real? Because I saw a tweet about that and was just like, yeah, very funny.
Yeah, no, he's in it. Yeah. Apparently he's like one of the pilots of a spaceship or something.
Okay.
I don't know why. And I don't know. And especially sports people appearing as actors in games. I mean, you don't see it happen often, but if the journey in FIFA 16 was anything to go by with Harry Robot Kane, Harry Emotionally Dead Kane sitting there. There's a scene in there, I don't know if I've told you, where you bump into him in the dressing room and you get to be all leery to him back or whatever. And he says, he walks past you, like just as you're walking into the dressing room, he goes, oh, you're all right? And then you got a choice of what to say. And I chose for him to say, yeah, you ready for some competition? And then someone selected that. And Harry Kane replied, yeah, I am. Are you ready for competition? It's just like, whoa. Dude, Harry, you are walking NPC. Jesus Christ. Yeah, so I don't know what he's like in this. I've not seen the cutscene. But I know Conor McGregor's in it as well. He punches you at the start, which is, he's in it for about a second, but they've used him all over the marketing campaign, so.
It's significantly better than that. It's better than Harry Kane. I mean, it's,
is it?
Yeah, it's, no, definitely. I mean, the first third of the game is not that good. I mean, you know, when I first spoke to you about it, and I said, I'm not really enjoying this that much. I just want to go and play Destiny.
Yeah.
But then it does really begin to pick up. I mean, they've also got, like, space combat in the sense of, like, first person, you're in space floating around. And it's kind of like, you know, like the worst Bond film, like one of the worst Bond films, like Moonraker. It really feels like that. Like there's all these people like floating around shooting each other. It looks ridiculous. But I don't know. It's I really enjoy playing it, actually. It's just, and also the story is really short. It's a very, very short game. I mean, it was over just as it was starting to get good. I just wish they'd sort of pushed the boundaries a bit more with this, which I know they're not likely to, because
it's like every year,
they've got,
isn't it?
Yeah, they've got like a core audience that really like this, but there's real potential here, especially for the like for the space combat and everything. I really enjoyed that. It's just yeah, they could push it further, but
you said
won't.
Something interesting there, because the problem that I've had with these modern Call of Duty games is that you no longer feel like you're in a big team, like in an army, like it's the single player games I'm talking about here.
Mm-hmm.
You never feel like you're in this big team as an army anymore. You never feel like your back's against the wall and you're in this huge battle. It like, you know, those earlier Call of Duty games did, Call of Duty World at War, and you know, even Modern Warfare and stuff like that. They really felt like that. And then it felt like, I think with the first Black Ops was the first one where it felt more like a Bond game, like you were James Bond rather than a soldier fighting against an army. And that's where I kind of started to drift away from them. Last year was the first Call of Duty campaign that I never completed. And I've got no interest in this one because it's just not what I want from, you know, those sort of games anymore.
How short is it, James? Sorry, you said it's really short, but how short?
I don't know. I mean, I think it may be sort of a time perception thing. To me, it felt short, but then maybe it isn't. It's one of those sorts of things where I'm really
starting
sure.
to feel like he hasn't played it, lads. I don't know about you. Starting to get
hours. I don't know how long I played it in hours. I wrote the review
a couple of months ago, the fella.
I used to like the fact that the Call of Duty single player campaigns were short. It was like a 4 or 5 hour, you know, action movie romp, and I enjoyed it for that. But
that's what's annoying about this, because it feels like it could continue. Like, it really feels like it could have gone on for like a lot longer. I mean, the story is really weak, which is a shame, because it really feels like they tried to put a lot of effort into it, like to try and make it better. But yeah, it's really, really super binary. It's like, you know, good versus evil. I mean, even like during like the cutscenes and everything, or like during the loading screens, it has like quotes from like, you know, the bad guys, and it's like, yeah, these are really evil. It's just there's no subtlety at all, which kind of ruins it a bit, because it could have been a lot more interesting, you know, if they'd have tried that. But yeah, no.
Weird. Well, I'm interested to hear what you think of the multiplayer next week, I assume.
Yeah, I will give it a go. It's
because I don't know what you're like. We haven't, as much as we've played together online, we haven't actually played many competitive multiplayer games together, have we? Other than football games.
Not for a long time. We used to play like, original Xbox almost. Like, well, no, we used to play like Rainbow Six a lot. Like,
I can't remember how good you were at those games. I think you were quite good, right?
Yeah, not bad. Yeah, like not awful, but not amazing or anything.
We'll see. This will be interesting, because that really does change your experience with these sort of games. If you're just getting absolutely, I mean, Battlefield 1 is perfect for that, because there'll be certain times where you play it and you're just getting shot and killed over and over, and you just think, I never want to play this fucking thing again.
Exactly. That's why I started to move. I mean, I really prefer co-op games. Like, I really, really prefer playing co-op games, because I don't like playing online with people that much, like in competitive, because it's just horrible. People are horrible on there, and it's just like, why would I want to do that?
They keep killing me in the head before I can even get my gun up, David. They're horrible to me on there. I don't like it. What else you been playing?
We also played the Trail as well.
Yes.
Which so is the Trail
real game. Come
Peter
on.
Molyneux's game. Have we all been playing this? Because I've played this as well.
Okay.
I've probably
No, I haven't. I downloaded it. I never started it.
Yeah. I haven't, but I probably played about 45 minutes of it. But so this is Peter Molyneux's new mobile phone game that sort of come out without any lies from him. And it's
any statement at all.
It's weird. It's a walking game where you just walk and then you pick things up, right? What did you
And then
think?
They ask you for money.
How much have you played of this, James?
I've probably played about an hour or so. So not,
right,
not
so
much.
Just maybe just a little bit ahead of me. And Sean, what have you, how far into it are you?
I was just looking at the info to see if it actually tells you, which it doesn't, but I'm like a good few hours into this.
Right. This is gonna be interesting then. I'm interested to see. I've got a feeling Sean and James have different views on this computer game. James, go.
Well, okay, so first of all, it does look lovely, and I do, like, the music is nice as well, and in the beginning I was kind of annoyed by it because I couldn't listen to podcasts at the same time, but then I did, you know, you obviously realise that actually it's an integral part of, like, creating the atmosphere for the game, and it does, I don't know, it's kind of nice to play, you know, it's quite relaxing, I think, you know, to sort of go through, but it's the microtransactions which kind of destroy it for me.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Explain the microtransactions, because with the 45 minutes that I've played, I didn't notice any.
Well, they do start to pop up in the sense of things become very repetitive. It's very like, because the thing is, like, you have to use, like, you need like money to like do things like, you know, use a boat to cross a river and stuff. And in the beginning, they just give you this, you know, to let you go through so that you can sort of start to get into it. But then later on, that doesn't happen so much, and you have to start sort of grinding things so that you can actually, you know, get it. But then there's also this whole sort of like, they got this like, watch this advert and we'll give you stuff, like mechanic as well. You know, it's like, watch this, like, you know,
that,
you know,
is, that is really awful. Like, yeah, you're happily walking down the road, and then this awful woman runs past you, and she's got like a big billboard on her, and she says in this awful fake French accent, like, "Oh, watch this, and we'll give you something free." And it's always, you know, it's just an advert for a shit game that you can also play on your phone.
Goddess,
yeah, please play Goddess. And that's annoying. I mean, you can just run past her and ignore it, but
it breaks the illusion.
A little bit irritating. Like, yeah, like, what I think the only thing that really, like, I'm enjoying it despite all this, although I can't refute any of it. I think what puzzles me is that the adverts are so pervasive that I'm never going to spend any money on this.
Yeah.
Like ever, because I'm just going to be like, well, you know, there's this deal on at the moment where it's like £6.50 and you get like a load of gear and some in-game money and stuff like that. And it's like, yeah, but it's not going to make the fucking adverts go away. So yeah. Forget it.
That's a good point.
And that's what I really hated about it, because it is like, it does look so nice, and they've got the atmosphere is really nice. But yeah, then it's like, as soon as they start to add in all that sort of microtransaction stuff, you start to feel like, yeah, this has just been designed to try and get money out of me. Mm. And
but
I know
every game.
No, but that's the whole point. It's like, this is the problem with free-to-play, though, isn't it? Where it's like the whole game is built around that, where I know that all games are trying, you know, they're trying to make money, but they're also, most, you know, good games are also trying to tell an interesting story as well, or trying to, like, engage you in some way. Whereas this feels really cynical, like, in the way it's trying to make cash out of you.
There is a bit of a story. Have you had to write to someone yet? Have you received a letter?
No, I haven't done that, no.
So there's not a massive amount to it. Just occasionally you'll get a letter from, like, you can decide if it's like a parent or like a lover or something like that. And basically they send you letters about how things are going back home badly, generally seems to be the thing. And then you sort of write your reply, and you can sort of choose like the options. Like occasionally you'll just be like, oh, and I have learned how to do this. And it'll be like hunting or crafting little wooden birds or something like that. So it's not massive. In fact, now that I think about it, I think it's been nicked almost entirely from Final Fantasy Crystal Chronicles. but it's quite nice, I suppose. Basically, the thing I'm enjoying about it, so I'm into like the mountains now. And I'm sort of, like, at the moment, I'm just following those little quests you get to learn like new crafting recipes and stuff.
Yeah.
So, and you know, and it'll be like gather 12 feathers or 6 pine cones or whatever. And then but I'm at a point now where I can just look at the map and like go back to different parts of the trail and be like, right, well, here's where the pine cones are, here's where the feathers are, here's this, that, and the other. And then I'm just sort of doing that and gathering stuff and crafting stuff. And I'm, against my better judgment, I am quite enjoying myself. I think basically Peter Molyneux just realized this would be a good week to give everyone a game where you just fuck off to nowhere and all you have to worry about is just walking around and crafting stuff.
Yeah. this is why I've gone back to Animal Crossing. it feels amazing to play that after what's been going on.
Yeah. But he also understands that a business is quite important and should be things should be run as a business, so give him some money, you know what I mean? Yeah, so
it's like you can see like little sort of what I would say are Molyneux-esque quirks that are probably nothing to do with him. Just little things like the inventory management, in that you've got this sack and everything you pick up just sort of falls into it, and you inevitably start picking up too much stuff and things are like falling out of the bag, and anything that falls out of the bag you've then got to, you know, pick it up again off the floor and put it back in, sort of try and arrange things, and sort of inevitably what you end up doing is like, you've got everything that's in the bag, but you can just sort of keep piling stuff on top as long as you do it really carefully.
Yeah,
and it almost becomes this little mini game.
The inventory in this is, so yeah, you've got a the top of a bag at the bottom of your screen and you sort of pile things up on it. And they, that becomes its own sort of balancing physics minigame, keeping everything in the bag. So I played about 45 minutes of this and I just, it's not really for me, to be honest with you. I thought it did look pretty. It was seemed like a good idea. It was just the control stuff. Everything you control in the game seemed a little bit too tedious for me to keep hold my interest. And when I'm playing mobile games, what I've sort of realized now is that a mobile game should ask me, the way I stick with a mobile game is how much enjoyment I get out of actions that I'm doing on my phone. So like, obviously, as I've said, favorite game on mobile was Freeze, and that's because the swiping feels so satisfying to do, and connecting things by swiping. I don't know, it does something to my brain, and I enjoy actually using that app, you know, beyond actually playing the game. It's the same with things like New Star Soccer and stuff like that. It's all about the motion that I'm actually doing something with my hands. With this, it was more okay, I swipe up to make them walk a little bit faster, but then I didn't quite understand the management of my power bar with that. Then you sort of just look around, and if you see something, you sort of drag it towards yourself, and that didn't hold my interest enough to keep me playing. Also, there was this really weird bit where I found someone exhausted on the floor.
Oh, do you know, I was going to mention this because I was annoyed about that.
You must have done the same thing as me, because I tried to give the person an apple and it didn't work, and I accidentally touched the item that was next to them. And then my companion went, "You're a fucking thief."
So that's like a little scripted event, isn't it? And the woman comes up and says, like, "Oh, here's someone who's passed out." And it was like, you could steal their stuff.
Doesn't even say steal. It just says you could pick up their stuff. So I was like, okay, I'll pick it up. And it's like, "You're a thief." And it's like, hang on, you just told me to do it.
Fucking hell, James. How old are you?
But James not understanding the concept of thieving.
Of stealing.
What I was saying was that I didn't even mean to do it. It was as if, like, I tried to give the person an apple. It's such a stupid thing to moan about, but that's so un-Molyneux. You know what I mean?
No, it's completely misreading your intentions. I'm pretty sure, like, when you collapse, it says, like, oh, do you want to wait and see if someone comes by and revives you? Because I think, like, that is a thing that people can do. So it's weird that they sort of put that scripted bit in as a tutorial. And because it just sort of goes, oh, you could, you know, take what's on the ground. It doesn't go, you could steal their stuff or you could revive them. It's up to you. So it just sort of fails as a tutorial bit.
So here's a question. Is there any sort of multiplayer stuff in it? Like, can you leave messages for other players on the trail? Can you interact with anyone else outside of the app?
Not as far as I know. You've got, like, when you're at camps and stuff, you've got like little sort of preset messages you can pick from, which is just like, well done, thanks, hello, sorry, stuff like that. And like, other people are around, but the actual interaction with them seems pretty limited. I mean, there's the little trading mini game, which I think is pretty good. It's not good, but it's diverting enough. Like, it's more interesting than it needed to be, in that you have this conveyor belt on the screen, which is slowly sort of pushing everything into a grinder at the end. And you have to just chuck your stuff on the conveyor belt. And then the closer it gets to the grinder, the less it's worth. But it's like, you still get a bit of money for anything that goes into the grinder. But like, the whole idea is like, you're putting stuff out that you think people will actually want to buy off you, and then they'll sort of grab it before it reaches the grinder.
But again, that's all with interacting with like sort of artificial intelligence, you know what I mean? It's not actually,
well, I've been trying to figure this out, people, because right? I'm definitely it does it with other people who are sat around the campfire, but I've definitely put stuff down that is worthless and people are grabbing it, and I don't know why. So I do suspect that might be bollocks.
I don't think it's real people, right? I think it's just, you know, in-game characters that are working on stats and whatever as you're going along. That's the thought I got from it, but I was still like very early on, definitely part of the tutorial, so I wouldn't expect that to be a real person anyway at that stage. But yeah, it'd be interesting. Yeah,
I'm intrigued that basically the goal is like getting to this town that's like a 15-kilometer hike away. And it looks like once you get there, like it's a different fucking game. From what I can tell, is it's always like, oh yeah, you know, you'll need to build a house and like you basically you're building this town up and improving it and stuff. Although inevitably that's just going to mean more going back on the trail and picking up, you know, rabbit skins.
It's
going to
be like Goddess, where it's like that's not actually done yet.
Yeah, come back in 2017. Well, or it could be worse. It could be like No Man's Sky. Can we even tell you what actually happens in the center of the universe on that yet? Probably not, right? You still determined with to get me there, James?
Actually, I haven't played it for ages. You could just tell me. I've lost interest now.
Matt?
Yeah, you can tell me. I don't care either.
Should we do a spoiler bot?
Better add, but I mean, I do feel we should make clear that like you can't spoil something that's already crap.
Yeah. Okay, spoiler bot, are you there?
Yes, but I have a new voice because the program you used to create me is fucked.
Yeah, we're gonna spoil the end of No Man's Sky now.
You can't spoil something that's shit in the first place.
I know. Sean's just made that point, but just tell him how long to fast forward.
2 minutes and 14 seconds.
Okay, right. So I gave you a hint a few weeks ago about what's at the center of the universe, and I said, think of the worst possible thing that can happen, and it's that. What did you think it was?
I don't know.
Matt, any ideas?
You die.
Okay. James?
I don't know. There's nothing there.
Right. You're both kind of right, I guess. it just zooms right back out, as far out as it can, and you start again with none of the stuff that you had.
Okay, you're joking, right?
No. Look it up on YouTube. It's fucking hilarious. There's some shitty music. The camera zooms back out and you start on a planet again.
It doesn't even say well done or anything like that.
It doesn't, does
What's
it,
What's the
Sean?
Point of that?
I don't know. Why hype it up? Like, why even mention there's a center of a universe if that's the case?
Should we, while we're here, should we talk about how the Atlas thing plays out as well?
Yeah, what's
I
that
don't
about?
Know. I don't know that, Sean.
Oh, do you not? Oh, fuck me. Right. So, you know, so the Atlas story path, which is you finding all these monuments and stuff and you're getting these Atlas stones. The Atlas stones, I presume you've been selling them when you get them, yeah? Because they're worth a fortune.
Well, I've been keeping them because I heard they were endgame stuff.
Okay. Basically, when you get to the final Atlas station, if you've got those 10 Atlas stones, each one of which takes up an inventory slot, mind you, and is worth a load of money, if you've got all 10, it gives you the ability to create a new planet, but it literally just tells you it's done it and it doesn't tell you where it is or what it is.
No way.
Or anything. If you haven't got all 10 Atlas stones, it's just like, oh yeah, sorry, you can't do this. Bye.
Brilliant. See, and I'm not surprised that people were so angry about this game now. You know?
Well, this is it, isn't it? They weren't hacked. Right.
It's weird, though, isn't it, how they've gone completely silent. Like, there's been nothing. And there was that whole thing.
Apparently,
saying,
there's a massive patch on the way. But
yeah, I'm sure.
We'll see. Okay, right. Anything else for us, James?
No, that's it. Oh, I started playing Uncharted 2. Which is, I'll tell you more about next week.
Well, hold on. Very different from the first one, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really much, much better. But yeah, go on.
Good. We'll get there. Okay, should I do mine?
Yeah, sure.
I'm going to talk about Time Splitters 2. I'm going to talk about Titanfall 2, the multiplayer, because we haven't really spoken about that. I want to touch on the single player as well, because Sean... said last week that you wanted to talk to me about it, so I was quite honoured. but I just want to say this to start with, because I've been talking about it on Twitter and stuff, and I don't want to be like overblow things and sort of just sensationalise things. I want to be very, very clear on my standpoint of Titanfall 2. Titanfall 2 is the best computer game ever made by anyone ever on any system of any period of time. It's the best game ever. 10 out of 10. Sean, what did you think of the single player campaign?
It's really good.
It is good, isn't it?
It's fucking wicked, yeah. There was maybe a couple of bits I could have lived without, but it's only like because the rest of it is so like relentlessly inventive and enjoyable. And so when there's like an occasionally slightly duff bit, you're like, ah, oh, fuck this. Like the boss battles in general wasn't too hot on those.
Well, the boss battles were, I found the boss battles really, I mean, they were there. And we took part in them. I don't know what else they could have really done. And the weird thing about those boss battles is that the first time I did, like, the first couple, I was trying to hold back, I was trying to be tactical, and I was getting my ass handed to me. And then you realise that if you just, like, smash the shit out of them, they're over in about 30 seconds, and they're not difficult at all. So actually hanging back and trying to be tactical with all your abilities just doesn't work. You've really just got to hammer the boss. And once I worked that out, they just... I mean, I was disappointed by them because the rest of the game is so spot on. The boss battles really aren't.
I mean, yeah, like it's one of those ones, you know, it's fucking special because you don't even want to talk about the mechanics of a lot of bits. And when you're worried about mechanical spoilers, that's a good thing.
It is a good sign, yeah.
Like I thought the way it ended was massively predictable, but still quite well done. The whole like the relationship with BT and stuff is wicked.
There's proper that one good. Scene.
Like, considering, you know, like when they said, you know, like, oh yeah, we're doing a single player campaign, and everyone's like, no, I don't fucking need it. It's fine. Just do good multiplayer again. Like they could have, like, considering this was, as far as we were aware, just a move to make sure it shifted a few more copies.
Yeah.
You know, because everyone thought it's the first one suffered because there was no proper campaign. Yeah. Like they could have just phoned it in and done, oh look, you shoot some lads, it's fine. Here's a bit of a story, maybe. Like, they've definitely put way more into it than anyone would have asked of them, I think, which is really cool.
Well, I think they've gone way beyond that. I think they've genuinely made a fantastic campaign. And all right, it may feel not as complete as, some single-player focused first-person shooters, mainly because of the length of it. But I think the amount of ideas and different things that it does totally makes up for that. But yeah, were you talking about the Titan, your relationship with the Titan? I wasn't that bothered about the Titan, to be honest with you, until it did. And I'm trying to dance around what actually happens. The scene where he does something with his hand. Do you know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah.
Sean, John Denton sent me a video of him reenacting that. And it is one of the funniest things I've seen, if not this year, in my life. I watched it about 50 times. It's the funniest thing I've ever seen. If I get the chance, I'll ask him if I can send it to you because it is absolutely fantastic. So I could see what you're saying. I think I was a little bit higher on it than you were, and maybe that was because you'd heard a lot of stuff, like a lot of
positive comments. Yeah, like by the time I played it, everyone was banging on about how good it was, and you know, it gets to that point where it doesn't matter how good it is. You're just like, yeah, all right, fucking shut up. But
Bad.
I mean, the fact that I finished it in like two sittings, I mean, it is short, but it's still rare for me to do that, even with short games. I was just like fully like, no, fucking, I will keep going. Like, I'm not.
You just don't get bored, do you? There's no point.
It doesn't let you.
No, there's a couple of points where I was kind of like. I think it was mainly the first 30 minutes to 45 minutes, although it had a clever idea. Okay, so we could probably talk about that first level. So the first level, you find a Titan. No, you don't. The first level, you kind of get given a Titan, but it's in a bad state and you've got to fix it up to get into it. I mean, that is about as... If a Titanfall game didn't start there, you'd be wondering what the fuck was going on. That was the obvious way to start. It's got a clever idea in that you feel like you're travelling away from the Titan for ages and you realise you're actually still in the same sort of area and you return to fix up the Titan once you've collected everything you needed to. although that had that cool idea, it wasn't enough to sort of feel like it was anything special, right? And that opening area, I'd say 30 minutes, 45 minutes, little bit slow. And at that stage, I was kind of thinking, what's everyone raving about? It's not until once you get past that that things start really picking up and new ideas start coming at you. So although part of me thinks, yeah, I probably could have done without that first level, I still thought it was okay. You know what I mean? It wasn't.
It's got to be there. Like, it couldn't just go in all guns blazing. That build up, isn't it? Like,
yeah. And it was still essentially working as a tutorial at that point, because there are a lot of obvious sort of areas where it's like, okay, it's teaching you that you should be wall running across this thing and that sort of stuff. But I can't remember from that point. I can't remember one moment where I thought I could do without this bit. You know, even those even those sort of really average boss fights were kind of like, okay, well, they're done now, and there was lots of exploding. That was pretty fun. Now let's get on to the next bit. Just fucking superb. Like, it's better than it ever needed to be. No doubt.
I think one really nice touch is the way that for the Titan, you just pick up other loadouts. And you can just switch between them.
Yeah, it doesn't.
And it makes no fucking sense, but it's good. It's like, fine.
Well, it does a few things like that where it breaks the rules of the multiplayer just to keep things fun. You can carry two primary weapons. Didn't really need to do that, but there you go. You can't do that in the multiplayer. You either have a sidearm or a anti-Titan weapon as well as your primary weapon. But this one just lets you mix it up with two. There are bits like that it just goes, okay, let's actually think about what makes this more fun in single player. What matters in multiplayer doesn't necessarily matter in the single player campaign. So they've changed things to sort of make it work, which is cool. The multiplayer then. Now, when I first played the beta, I think we talked about it on this show. I was concerned there was a few decisions that were made. And it really didn't feel like it was up there with Titanfall, the original game. It's funny because I was so used to Titanfall. I played hundreds of hours of it, and I knew that game inside out. I knew all the maps like the back of my hand. I knew what abilities worked for me and which ones didn't. And when I started on Titanfall 2, I tried to match all the abilities and take everything that I learned from the first game and just force it into the second game, and it doesn't work like that. And I advise anyone that goes into this slightly worried that all the stuff that you used to doing in the first game that seems even nerfed or just doesn't work in the second, stick with it and mix up your builds. Keep changing until you find something that works. So in the first game, I didn't use the cloaking. I used the sort of radar detection stuff. And which allows you to see through walls, and that was really handy in the first game, and I sort of used it as a real sort of pillar in my gameplay. And that in this one, they've taken that ability out completely and changed it with this little radar thing that you throw, and then it lets the whole team see through walls, but only in that specific area, and only for a very limited amount of time. So basically all these sort of abilities have either been moved to boosts or just been nerfed for your standard abilities. I found that throwing device thing didn't really work the way that I wanted it to work. I wasn't really into it. So I moved over to cloaking, and my God, the cloaking stuff is I find it so much more useful in this game than I did the last. And, you know, there's all sorts of different rules to the cloaking. Like, if you're cloaked, then a Titan can't see you, but another pilot can. You know, they can see like an outline of you and stuff like that. It also means that your character's shape changes. And if you're cloaked, you turn into this guy wearing this huge coat. Like, and so when you're not cloaked, you stand out a lot more on the battlefield than anyone choosing any of the other abilities. So although there's the advantage of the cloaking stuff, there's a lot of disadvantages of using that specific character. And that's a theme, that's just like a small example of a theme that runs throughout. Because everything you do in the game has advantages and disadvantages. If you're using a certain ability, you're not using something else that can counter that ability. And the more you play, the more you realise that although you've found what you think is a complete cheat of a build that will absolutely tear people apart without you getting touched, you look around and there are people doing better than you using a completely different build. You know, there's so many different ways to build up your pilot and your Titan and work them together that that it feels that everything is so balanced. There's no one style of pilot that's winning games, game in, game out. You know, there's not one weapon that seems better than others. I've seen such a mix of different weapons on the battlefield that it's nailed that balance that made Titanfall 1 so good. The second thing it does, I was tasked with trying to convince my main group of friends that I play online games with to buy Titanfall, because they've all got Battlefield and that's all they're playing at the moment. And I said, look, you can't compare the two games. Battlefield is an incredible game in its own right, but that's all about teamwork and huge scale battles and these objectives and stuff like that. Titanfall 2 feels like you're putting a pound into a really good arcade game, and although it might not have the tactical stuff that Battlefield has got, it's got non-stop action and non-stop moments where I've used the Xbox Record That feature so much for this game because I'm constantly doing cool shit. There was one I posted up on Twitter and stuff where I took down a Titan, then shot a pilot through a window, then my Titan got doomed. I launched into the air, entered my cloaking ability, landed behind two pilots firing at our Titans from this rooftop, and just snapped both of their necks because they couldn't see me because I landed behind them. There was another one where I was chasing this other Titan non-stop in my tight, and I was just chucking grenades at it, finally doomed him. He ejected, launched up into the air, and when he was right as high as he could be, I fired a grenade, it splattered him in the air. It was just felt amazing. And this game constantly makes me feel like a god. Like, constantly. That particular one, that second example that I used, was at an end of a game where I lasted the whole match without dying and got 18 kills. I never do that in a game. And don't get me wrong, in the next game I played, I couldn't buy a kill. I was getting fucked over completely. But it has so many moments where you just think, yes! Like, the highs far outweigh the low points of frustration. And by the end of the round, I just want to play another round again. I'm mainly playing attrition at the moment. I've played Hardpoint. I like all the game modes, really. Even Pilot versus Pilot is a lot better in this game because there's a certain map that if you play on that mode, it feels really, really good. There's a lot of standoffs. And in fact, actually, there's two maps. There's one where you look up a hill, another one where you're in loads of like sort of domed areas all linked together with corridors. Those two maps are fantastic for Pilot versus Pilot. I think Last Titan Standing is not quite as good as it was last time round, mainly because the maps feel a little bit more closed off rather than completely open. But I've not played on every map on that game mode yet, so maybe I'm just missing out on sort of the correct map to play that on. There's a bounty hunt, which is just insanely frustrating, but also has this ebb and flow, which is...
I am maybe just a bit too shit.
Stick with it, because I think you'll find that a lot of people around you are in the same boat. I think you assume that everyone's got like pockets full of cash, and they haven't. So with Bounty Hunt, the idea is that there's challenges that both teams have to do. And what that is, that's usually an area where there's loads of grunts that you have to take down as many as possible, or the two Titans get dropped and you've got to blow them up. The more damage you do to the objectives, the more cash you get in your pocket. And then once that round is over, two banks spawn, and you've got to make it to the bank and cash that money before getting shot by other pilots. If you get shot by other pilots, you lose 50% of what's in your pocket. And it's incredibly frustrating because, I mean, I've had $400-$500 in my pocket, and just to get shot by some prick from behind, losing $200 feels fucking awful. But as I say, I think that's kind of the way everyone feels when they play that game. You're not on your own, so it is frustrating. But once the more you play it, the less frustrated you get, because you kind of think, oh no, this is just a normal thing. Me losing $200 is not the end of the world. It seems to be happening to everyone in this game mode. But the ebb and flow of that is fantastic, because you go from battling these computer controlled characters to turning your gun on a pilot that you can see in the corner of your screen, also trying to battle them, to then suddenly trying to set up base around a bank to take out any pilots that's trying to bank, kill them before they get there so you can nick their money and bank it yourself. It's wonderful. I stole like $130 off one guy just about to cash in. It felt so good. Amped Hardpoint, we spoke about it before. That's really good. Really good fun. The biggest problem I've had so far is that I haven't played in big teams like I did in Titanfall, so I'm finding it hard to grasp what works in terms of team play and what doesn't, and if the team play stuff is still in this game. I've mainly been playing on my own, but every time I've played it, I've had an amazing time. There's not been one bad session. Again, just full of ideas. My favourite idea in the multiplayer is that you can level up all your guns, and when you get them high enough, you get a little ticker on the side of your gun telling you how many kills you've had from using it. It's beautiful. My main weapon's up to, I think it was 480 last night, kills with that one gun. Feels fucking good, man. Every time that ticks over with two zeros at the end, it's beautiful. I'm trying to break it. I'm trying to get it to 1,000 because there's only 3 counters on it. I want to see what happens. It's the most fun I've had in an online shooter, full stop. And I've played, I'm including Time Splitters 2, GoldenEye, Halo, all those games. This is the most fun I've had. I'm not saying it's, well, I am saying it's the best. It's the best, first-person shooter I've played, multiplayer shooter. And when I say it's the best game, that I've played, obviously there are several best games I've ever played. There are games that have affected me emotionally through story. There are games that blow me away visually. And, you look at Battlefield 1 and the amount of work that's gone into making that game work, be it just introducing the amount of players that are playing at once or the sort of tactical element behind the game is absolutely stunning and blows me away. But for this, the sheer fun factor and the stuff you do within the multiplayer that isn't driven by set pieces, obviously, because it can't do that in a multiplayer, but just the mechanics of the game steering everything towards you doing cool shit constantly is just incredible. And it just makes me want to give up my job and move to a remote village that has a decent internet connection and sit and play this all day, every day until my eyes fall out. It's fantastic. Properly fantastic. I've even ordered it on PS4 now, so I've double dipped on it just so I can play it with other people. Because
can I borrow really your Xbox One version?
No, you can't, James, because I'm going to be switching between both.
Yeah.
Literally, that is genuinely what I'm going to do. I've got friends on PS4 that are going to be playing it. I've got friends on Xbox. I'll be switching between both, no doubt. I'm going to break those tickers on both those games, man. Fuck.
Yeah, like I know I'm excited for you getting the PS4 version, because I'm in the same boat in that I've not played it with mates properly yet. So I've got no sense of the sort of interplay between the different abilities and classes, if you can call them that. Whereas, I've said on Twitter, I sort of still prefer Overwatch a little bit.
Yeah, it's insane, but yeah.
Just because Overwatch is sort of very committed to not pissing you off when things go wrong, in that you always feel encouraged with Overwatch, whereas I've definitely had a few shiters on Titanfall 2 and just been like, I'm having a bad evening, I don't want to play this.
Well, because I joke when I say, like, you can't compare Overwatch with Titanfall. They're going for different things.
Yeah.
They're completely different games, exactly. And they're both good in their own right.
Yeah,
I think maybe you're a little bit too worried about how you're performing on like one of the great things it does in attrition, it doesn't show how many times you've died at the kill screen at the end. It's because it's not about that. I mean, you're expected to die a lot in this game. You've just, I think, Sean, when we play, we're just going to really just smash different abilities, try different things. And I think once you find your build, that'll be it. You'll see a completely different side of this game. Because it took me a while to get there as well. And when I first started playing it, I was like, this is not as good as one, but it's okay. And I don't mind playing it, so I'll continue playing it. And then I found things that I like doing in the game, and then I started piecing things together. Like, you know this new battery system?
I fucking love that.
It's a good idea, right?
Yeah.
And I saw someone complaining about it on Rollmuck today, saying, the problem is, once you steal the battery, the Titan gets a huge icon on their HUD that sits over the pilot's head as you're trying to get away. So they've got such an advantage to just wipe you out. And, you know, every time I get a battery nicked from me, if my smoke, anti-smoke stuff, my anti-pilot smoke stuff isn't built up yet, I just think, okay, I'll just wait because I'll be able to see exactly where they are. I'll kill them and nick my battery back. And it works non-stop because people don't know what they're doing yet. What they don't realise is that take an electronic grenade with you, because the moment you jump off that Titan with their battery, chuck it at the Titan and they can't see shit. You've got more than enough time to escape from there. Also, if you've got the grappling hook, just stick the thing, then zoom off up into a rooftop or something. There are ways around that stuff. And that's why it's so important that you find the right build, because if you are good at nicking batteries, you need to have the right equipment to get away.
Feels like one of those games that you just sort of, like, I don't know if you get this, especially with online stuff, where you like, you're dying a lot and you just think, well, I'm just going to keep playing and I'll just get better, like just through practice. And you forget that you have to think and you have to like be like an active participant in your own learning about the game. You can't just keep throwing yourself into it and just think, oh well, my reactions will get better, I'll get better at aiming and wall running and all that shit. It's like, no, just fucking slow down and look at what's working and what isn't, and think about the abilities and how they work together and how the game operates. And those things exist, you know, those sort of not exploits, but you know what I mean, the sort of the way they interconnect and bounce off each other is really well done, I think.
Also, I would really recommend, if you're playing this and you're failing to totally get into it, spend some time in the sort of practice area, the tutorial mission, learning how to wall run properly and learning the mechanics of it. I mean, it's pretty obvious what you're supposed to do, but it's pretty hard to get bang on to it, because once you start working that stuff out, it's more of an advantage in this game than it was the last, because your speed boost is so big on this. Like, you just absolutely zip through maps if you're wall running or sliding and stuff like that. Basically, you should never be running along the floor. It just doesn't, there's no advantage of doing that. You're just leaving yourself open to get absolutely hammered. It's all about wall running and getting into positions behind pilots that work so well, man. It's good. It's good. Anyway, that's why I love that game, and I'm sure I'll be talking about it more before the end of the year. And I'm sorry that people are getting tired of me on Twitter just banging on about it, and people will get tired of me banging on about it on this. But at the end of the day, as I said on Twitter, man, there's a lot of negativity all over social media at the moment. Just allow me to fucking gloat. To just
let me have this.
Let me have this. At least it's positive. All right? And also buy it, because it hasn't sold that well. Fucking more people bought Forza Horizon 3 this month than they did Titanfall, and that's absolutely gutting for me. I just hope it's like Rainbow Six and it just continues. On the complete opposite end of the spectrum, I've been playing Everybody's Gone to the Rapture.
Hey!
You've played this, Sean, right?
I have. I've actually been back to it since we talked about it, because I knew this was going to come up, and I'd only, like, I bought it ages ago, but I foolishly bought it the week before I got married. So basically I had like one evening on it and then went to get married, and then obviously life stops. And obviously it's since been on PlayStation Plus. So well done me, 15 quid down the toilet.
But now I like it. I'm not saying it doesn't have problems, but I am a fan of it. But how are you getting on?
Well, you know, because I text you and I
know,
but
for the show, Dave,
something happened to change my opinion very slightly. I got to the end of the first story and it did some cool shit to the environment that made me go, wow, that looks pretty. My problem with the game is that, well, A, it runs like shit on PS4. I mean, going from 60 frames of Titanfall to this is an absolute shocker. I mean,
I think it's absolutely fine. I've
noticed the frame rate is dog shit, Sean. It's whatever. Dog shit. You know it's got the run. You know it's got the run button on it, right?
Yeah.
You know it works sort of incrementally, like it slowly built up. I can see when the speed of my character is going up each notch. Fucking hell, because it jolts a bit. Like it drops a frame when it's going. Okay, you're going a bit faster.
Okay, I've genuinely not noticed that, but I'll believe you.
For a game that is it's a story driven game. If you've not heard about this game, you start off on a village that's completely empty, and there's this sort of yellow light that kind of leads you around, but it doesn't really. It does some weird shit. I don't get what it's trying to do at all times. It's a bit weird. But you stumble across different houses and different areas of this village, and these sort of weird light ghosts appear, and they talk to each other and act out sort of a scene in front of you, and you sit and you watch that and you move on. For a game that's focused on that sort of stuff, the story so far is full of no intrigue, and I've got no interest in any of the characters or what they're doing in it. Literally nothing, Sean. Like I said to you in the week, Gone Home is a very similar game. There's not action in it. It's, you know, there's a lot of walking about and just taking in a story and experiencing a story and an environment. That sets you up with a premise. You know, girl comes home, her family are out, you're looking around a house. That gave me enough. And that was just a tiny little thing to set the ball rolling. And then the further you get into it, the more you start naturally realizing that stuff is going on between these characters and you want to hear more about it. On this, it just drops you in and it feeds you some shit and just goes, oh, and I just don't care about anything. Like, nothing. There's nothing they're talking about where I'm thinking, oh, no, wow, what's this mean? I've got no emotional attachment to anything that's going on. And that's
okay,
fucking
so
weird,
my enjoyment of, like, it is a weird story, in that, you know, like, it, a lot of it is, like, so, like, mundane. My enjoyment of it is derived from, like, we've all seen films or whatever where, like, cool, handsome young people deal with, like, weird sci-fi shit. What you don't see is how, like, the cast of the fucking Archers would react to weird sci-fi shit going on. Yeah. And that's sort of what I like about it, in that it's loads of just boring, normal people having something really weird happen to them and them sort of attempting to deal with that without, like, you know, loads of stupid sort of pop culture knowledge, and, like, and how, like, a lot of them sort of get really religious about it, or just they just cannot get their fucking heads around what's happening.
That is I don't even care. Like, I honestly, I don't care what these people think about it, because I think the voice acting is, there are a couple of decent voice actors in there, no doubt, but there's a lot of fucking terrible ones.
See, but again, I feel like the way it's recorded and delivered and everything about it, to me, is supposed to sort of remind you of the Archers. I don't suppose you've ever listened to it.
I've
never sat down and listened to it, but I'm, you know, vaguely aware of
it. I've heard the style, and the style is kind of, there's these, you're really aware that there's actors reading lines, and for a game like this, that's a fucking terrible thing to happen. The Archers, whatever, right? That happens, well, that's about, and people listen to it, fine. But I ain't into that, and I'm playing this, and you listen to the voice acting in, say, Gone Home, which is just monologues. That feels like it's got more passion in it than anyone I've met in this game. Mm-hmm. Like in this game, it literally does sound like people are just reading lines. Even when they're talking over each other, it feels like amateur dramatics. And that really put me off. Like it sort of disconnected me from the off. I was kind of like, oh man, this is really, really scripted.
I mean, my occasional frustrations with it are, as you say, you've got this ball of light which is sort of seems to be showing you the way to go,
and then like it just the fucks game off in a different direction or back to where you've just been, and you're kind of
you'll follow it a certain way, and then it'll go actually, and then it'll disappear behind you, and you sort of, oh fuck. Yeah. That's not successful. And even if it was, like, even if it just led you through the main story, you're aware that there's secret stuff hidden around. There's all, you know, other little sort of vignettes with characters and stuff. And if you don't want to miss those things, you're sort of like, well, the ball's going that way, so does that mean I should go anywhere but that
yeah,
way?
Yeah,
in order to, you know? So that's frustrating.
With that ball of light, though, that the one thing that I do appreciate that isn't part of the set pieces that you see, there are moments where you're looking over this incredible, because the game is stunning to look at, frame rate aside. Yeah. You know, these fields and the it really looks beautiful. There are moments where it looks like a painting or even a photo of this village, and you see this ball of light sort of traveling in the distance across the grass. That kind of got to me a little bit, because I was like, oh yeah, I'm in a game, you know what I mean? And wow, look at that looks really pretty, you know. It looks it's very artistic and it's very affecting at times. Just visually, I think that works. It's just there's nothing else that does about it for me. But anyway, sorry, you were saying?
No, just like I do have frustrations with it. The movement speed thing, it seems crass to be like, oh yeah, and you move around really slowly. I get why they've done it, but it does fucking take a long time to get around sometimes.
It's tedious as fuck, mate.
I do really enjoy absorbing the atmosphere, but especially like, because sometimes you have to do a bit of backtracking if you feel like you've missed something. It's like, well, I've gone this, you know, down this path, but I could have gone off this way, so I've got to work my way back. And that does, get pretty old. But no, like overall, I think it's a worthwhile thing to exist.
I went back and read a review of it. I think it was on IGN, and they were talking about how their favourite thing was how they were so invested into what was happening to this village and how things unfolded, and how their theories were proven wrong at certain points, proven right and other points, and that was really... And I just cannot relate to that, because I'm just like, who cares? Like, fuck off.
I really appreciate the mundanity of it, and what if something weird and inexplicable happened to a sleepy little rural village?
I couldn't give a shit, mate.
Where no one plays video games or watches films or... You know.
A place without Netflix. Fuck that.
The only character I really dislike is Kate, who's the woman who's seemingly responsible for everything that's going on.
The American woman.
Yeah.
Yeah, she just seems like a prick, doesn't she?
I mean, I don't know if it's all going to, you know, if I finish the game, it's all going to, like, make sense and turn around, but it basically seems like, so stuff's going wrong and people in the village are disappearing, and her partner, Stephen, who's involved in the research, is just constantly telling her, we need to fucking stop this, it's going wrong. And she's like, no, it's really important, we've got to carry on. And it's like, you're a dick, mate. but I don't know. I mean, maybe if you get to the end, it turns out she was right all along, but I don't know.
So James, you've downloaded this game, you're going to play it, are you?
I will play it, yeah. I downloaded it this evening, so I'll give it a go this week.
And Matt, you're still alive, right?
No, I died about half an hour ago.
All right, cool. No. Okay, so that was me.
Sean, PS4 Pro.
PS4 Pro. Sean, let's go for you now.
Right, so I've played, and I know you have also played, David, the closed beta of Steep.
I have.
Ubisoft's new skiing and snowboarding and wingsuiting and...
Just everything's fucking incredible. No,
paragliding game.
It's fucking brilliant, isn't it?
I'm not a fan.
Yeah, nor am I. It's dog shit. No, right. Can full
what is right? What,
full
what
disclosure.
Is it?
Actually, we need to say this first. Okay. This is an open beta. It's quite early on, right? When's this game coming out? Do you know?
It's next out year, in sometime. Like a week or two, isn't it? I thought it was quite soon.
No, Matt, can you check out the release date for Steep?
I'll check.
Full disclosure, this isn't the final game. Things may improve by the time it comes out. Now you can continue.
it just feels horrible. Do you not think? Like, it just, when you're snowboarding, there's no sense of speed.
Yeah, sorry, really, this game is out on 2nd December.
Oh yeah. My God, I did not know it was just around the corner. That makes this a lot worse then, because it's got so many problems that I don't know where to begin. And I was just assuming that this was really, really early build. I mean, the momentum is just not there, and that's basically down to how bad the physics are in this game.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
how you can, like, it doesn't feel that you're going down a hill. It feels like you're being dragged somewhere. I think if that makes
feels
sense.
Like it feels like the snow is like slowing you down. Like gravity's doing its best, but it's like you're fighting against it.
Where you're hitting, where you're going at what you feel is like a decent speed, and then you go to go up a ramp, and you just sort of stop before you reach
the
end.
Yeah, and when you just sort of, you know, you can go straight into a fucking rock or something, and you just kind of bounce off it. And
well, the rock stuff is weird, right? Because you've got a life bar. It kind of feels like a first-person shooter life bar where you can regenerate if you don't get hit. But if you scrape down a rock, so you're on your snowboard and you're just going down a rock, it treats that as losing health. So although you don't look like you're in any pain or danger, you suddenly start dying. And it's kind of like, why is that?
And it
happening?
Does the fucking, it makes the edges of the screen go red and you hear your guy heavy breathing like it's a fucking first person shooter.
It totally does that, yeah.
And it just, like, the whole thing just feels really, like, confused and messy. Like, the fact that it's, you know, I get this whole concept that it's just like, dude, here's a load of mountains from real life that we stitched together and you can just do whatever you want from them. But then, like, 10 minutes in, you're like, do you know what? I quite like it when game developers design things.
Yeah.
Like, courses.
I don't know how fair that is. Like, I think as a concept, it could still work. I just think there's actual problems. Like, as a concept, there's nothing wrong with it. As an execution of that concept, it fails to do a lot right. You know, there's the whole getting stuck on scenery stuff that is just... Yeah. There are moments where I'm trying to get from... It's telling me to go from this point to that point, right? That's one of the first tasks it lets you do. But if you slightly go the wrong way... There seems like no real way of getting back there without some either tediously walking through the snow or just resetting. And then when you finally do make it to that, you know, the goal, the track that leads you there doesn't feel like it's pushing you towards that. There's no real reason to take that sort of route to the destination because there's not set jumps. There's no real... anything really nice to look at. It just feels like, okay, you've made it to this bit now you need to make it to that bit, and there's no fun to be had so far. Control setups are fucking crazy, right? So usually you expect to hold X down to jump, or in more recent years you fiddle the stick to do all your jumps and your tricks. On this it's R2 and L2, which is also your grab the board button. It just feels complicated for, like, needlessly
complicated. And it's not really clear. So when you're snowboarding, it's not really clear. Like, so the left and right sticks do something slightly different to each other, but it's not really clear what I found.
Well, the right stick's flipping and the left stick's turning, I think.
But no, but like, just not even when you're jumping, when you're just on the ground.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Like,
I'm not really clear what the difference is between the two.
It's weird.
But yeah, the stunts are just like you spin for a bit and then you let go and he automatically rights himself I don't know if you've done, there's one of the challenges where it's like, oh yeah, like do shitloads of tricks before you get to the bottom or whatever. And then it lets you, like, it does this little tutorial where it's like, oh, and here's how you view like other people's replays. And it shows you like someone getting a really good score. And they're just fucking hitting things constantly and then just sort of doing shit little tricks constantly off tiny bits of scenery.
It's like they're more glitching it than they are actually.
Yeah, it just looks crap.
Yeah.
And it's just, yeah, like, weird. And it's one of those ones, like the fact that you can always just go to the map and like, just, you know, warp to like any one of these sort of, you know, points, like preset points. And initially like, oh, wow, that's really convenient. And yet somehow 15 minutes in, you're like, fuck's sake, like I've got to go back to the map and warp somewhere else. Like somehow it becomes really irritating.
Yeah, because it like there feels like no real way to get to the bottom of the mountain. It just feels like you're fumbling your way down a mountain rather than, and you know, the skate games felt a lot like this to start with. Maybe there's an art to it that we're missing, but it doesn't excuse the weird physics and the sort of lack of anything visually pleasing. You know what I mean? It really does feel like more of a demo than... All right, it is a demo. I get that. Mm. But what I'm saying is it's got the feeling of sort of a concept game rather than an actual full game that's just about to come out that I've just found out about.
Did you lose your mind when it showed you that full, that weird sort of radial pause menu with all the different coloured buttons on it and the fucking... Did you get to that bit?
I must have done. I played it for a while, but I don't remember anything jarring me like that.
It's like you just you do one bit where I can't remember. It's something like when it's teaching you how to upload replays or save a line or something.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh yeah, and then press this button, and it brings up this like pause menu, and it's like you've got this circle in the middle of the screen, and then there's about fucking 20 other tiny little circles all around it that are all color coded. Because they're parts of different menus, but they do different things, and you just look at it and you just go, "Oh, fuck off!"
Yeah, everything like, seems horrible. Like it's making it difficult for you. The UI is shocking, and as well as the control scheme, because it's the amount of times I was just wanted to do something, and suddenly I was in the map again. Which is me pressing the wrong button. I get that, but nothing feels natural. Like nothing. Yeah. Everything feels like you're struggling against what the game's actually asking you to do.
Also, like, I know it's realistic and they're all real mountains and stuff. Why does it feel like there's only about three colours in the whole game?
Yeah, it does. It really does. We just want tricky.
Yeah, what a shame. Like, I know a lot of people are like, you know, really big fans of SSX and Amped and all the rest of it. I've got no real history with snowboarding games, despite knowing that I would probably really enjoy them. I still feel like I should play the last SSX, because I gather, apart from the Deadly Descent bits, that was wicked. And I definitely really enjoyed the demo of that. But I just, to me, yeah, this supplies none of the thrill I would expect from a snowboarding game. And it's weirdly telling as well that I just feel like I'm just focusing on it as a snowboard game. I've got no interest in just like parachuting around. The wingsuit stuff is okay.
Did you find that the camera angle behind the wingsuit was just a complete ball ache? Because I had no sense of how close I was to things.
I was just hitting stuff all the time. And
you know, in the first bit, there's this little sort of cave that you can fly through.
Yeah.
I tried that about 8 times because it just felt that the camera was not telling me exactly where my dude was. And he was just clattering into walls and stuff.
Yeah.
Weird.
Yeah. Very, very odd. I mean, the skiing, I didn't even try.
No, I've not tried that yet, no.
Yeah. What a shame.
What a shame. Yeah. Okay, anything else?
I also... So I was very ill last week. I had a fucking bladder infection or something. We don't really know what it was. All I know is I spent 3 days absolutely off my face on Cocodamol. And I played The Tomorrow Children.
What is that?
So this is a free-to-play game on the PlayStation 4. And it's by... I've fucking forgotten the name, but it's the people who did all the Pixel Junk games. Is it Q Games?
I don't
games.
Know.
I want to say Q Games. Let's say it's Q Games, and I haven't just made that up. So I really liked a lot of the Pixel Junk games. I thought they were really good. This was announced at E3 a couple of years ago, and it looked weird then, and it's still weird now. So this is a game which is set, like, it's got all this sort of, it's all sort of Soviet styled, like, it's all, you know, everyone calls each other comrade, and it's all about working toward, you know, working for the betterment of society at large and stuff. And it's set in the future where there's been some sort of cataclysmic event that has basically destroyed all time and space. And all that's left is this place called the Void, which is just this endless gray plain. And occasionally, like, little islands rise out of it with resources on them. So you have, you're like a kid. You're all just like little girls, and you can change your outfits.
Tomorrow Child, yeah, gosh, that.
And you have like a town, and there's other people in it, like other players. It's an MMO, basically, kind of. You sort of assign to this town, and it's like, and you can build your own little house, and there's like sort of municipal buildings and shops and stuff. And basically, the town is repeatedly getting attacked by giant monsters who just sort of appear sort of on the horizon, and then you sort of all got to get in these turrets and shoot them and make sure they don't wreck the fucking town because you're all building it together. And then, yeah, and occasionally, like, these islands rise up in the distance, and you have to get on a bus, and it takes you out to these islands. And the islands are all fucking weird. Like, I saw one that was like, they were like, it was all made out of like giant boots that were like sticking up out of the ground, like upside down. And then another one was just all sort of like spheres. One was like a wrecked ship, like the hull of a wrecked like boat.
Sorry, are these randomly generated?
And you basically, I don't know. I've no idea, right? As I say, I was on a lot of painkillers at the time, but I gather this is just what it's like, you know, even if you're completely sober. Yeah, so you go out to these islands, and basically, and then it's like a slightly rubbish Minecraft, and you're sort of getting resources out of these things, and then hopping back on the bus and going back to town, dumping your resources off, and then players can like it's weird, you don't have, like, you've got your own inventory, but anything you gather, it's like none of it's for you, it's all for the town. So you just sort of, you take it back to town, and you just dump it in this, like, you know, this sort of shared resource area. And, like, the idea is amazing, but just everything about the execution is so confusing and weird that it's just impossible to get into. And it's a real shame because I think it's really interesting. But it's just, it's so difficult to get your head around.
Mm.
So, yeah, that's the Tomorrow Children.
Go get it now on PlayStation for free.
Yeah, mate, do that.
Sounds blinding. Right, is that it?
That is it.
Cool. Matt, what's going on, mate?
With what?
You've been very quiet. I'm worried about you.
Well, I haven't got time for, and I haven't played the Tomorrow Children, didn't play the Steep Beater or the Trail. So,
do you want to talk about that? Are you all right? I'm just worried about your well-being, mate. Have you got the headset on now? That's what I want to know.
I haven't taken it off since I got it, yeah.
We have got something to talk about. Apparently, yeah, Zelda's been delayed.
Some breaking news.
Yeah. You're kidding me.
Yeah, well, okay, this is Emily Rogers again, you know, who's been a pretty good source in the past, but yeah, she says it's been delayed till the summer now.
Oh my God, that is... What are they... Oh, so that's not going to be a launch game for the NX.
Do you want to know what the reasons are that she's given?
Go on.
Okay, so apparently localization on the game is a massive thing, and they're not anywhere near finished with it, and it might not finish until December. And then they need another 4 to 6 months of testing before they can release it, so it's like bug-free. So this is why summer is looking more likely now.
It's going to be a big blow.
They never said March was a release date. They just said 2017. Yeah, everyone just assumed.
I'm sure they said March at some point.
They gave an actual date. They said 24th.
Yeah. I definitely did. Well, not according to everyone on Gaff who's crying.
Okay.
They just said 2017, and everyone just assumed it would be, you know, because it was released the same time as because they assumed Switch and Wii U at the same time, they just put two and two together and assumed Switch launch title.
No, I think that's just, they're just bargaining at this point. Trying to make sense of it.
But it's just weird, because obviously that's massive, but if they can sort of turn around and be like, yeah, but there's a new Mario for the Switch in March, everyone's like, all right, fine.
Yeah, exactly.
That would help. But like, I mean, what if they delayed, you know, the Switch was delayed. What if they delayed it to make sure that Zelda was going to be a launch title? And now they're like, oh, no, it's really not going to be now. Fucking how furious would you be? Crazy. Okay, cool. Have we got any emails and thing this week, James?
We have, yeah. There's. Do you want me to read them?
No, actually, no.
That's the point of the section.
Go home.
It is gone midnight.
It's gone midnight.
You're fucking kidding me, is it really? Oh, yeah. Shit. Yeah. All right, go on. There's still a few.
Okay, so if you want to email us, it's thecomputergameshow@gmail.com. The first one is from Kurt Lewin, who says, there's been some great video game stories in recent years with games like The Last of Us, Uncharted, and Gone Home. This got me thinking, which Mario game, excluding the RPG ones, has the best storyline? I ask because I was watching IGN's video review of Captain Toad Treasure Tracker, which I've just finished and thought was excellent, and the reviewer stated that he thought the narrative was great and that he found himself genuinely rooting for the characters. I thought this was a strange statement because, as far as I could tell, the only difference from other Mario platform games was that it was Toadette getting kidnapped instead of Princess Peach and by an eagle instead of Bowser. Spoilers. I've just got the game. Anyway, quick question. Who is Dave's all-time favourite Millwall player? Keep up the good work.
Oh, well, so in terms of the Mario thing, Jesus, there really is, like, I mean, if you're looking for storylines in Mario, you need your egg checked, right? Because, Jesus,
yep. I mean, yeah, those, yeah.
Like, they gave a go at it with, like, Mario Sunshine. You know, they had the whole thing with
they
that.
They did, didn't they?
It wasn't very good.
No, it wasn't. In terms of favourite Millwall player, Jesus, I can't, probably Tim Cahill, you know, he was our best. By far, we let him go for next to nothing. Absolutely shocking. So I hope that answers your question. Next question.
Okay, Capone says, on PSN, I saw that James had started to play Virginia. I commented on this PSN update simply saying that he wouldn't like it. Was I right? Any news on when Dave Turners will be continuing streaming Metal Gear Solid 5, or was I bang on the money about that too?
Well, hold on. You weren't bang on the money about Virginia yet, James.
No, completely wrong. I absolutely loved it and think I really, really enjoyed playing it. And oh, cool. I'm hoping that some of you guys will play it as well so we can talk about it because it's really interesting.
I am planning to get it, yeah.
So. Why
yeah,
please have you mentioned it?
Who?
Why you? I'd never heard you talk about this game.
I only got it last week and we weren't on last week.
You finished it, right?
Yeah, I finished it today. It's like, you know.
Well, we're recording tonight.
No, because I wanted to think about it a bit before I start talking about it, and I was hoping that somebody else would have played it as well, because right. it's really interesting. I really wish some of you guys would play it.
Yeah, so someone at work recommended it to me and says it's amazing. How much do you say it was currently?
I got it discounted. I think it was $5.99, but I'm not sure.
Wow, that's cheaper than I thought.
Yeah.
I don't know. I will get back to Metal Gear Solid. There's been too much. Titanfall is my life now, so you got that for a while. Sorry. I might stream some of that when I get the PS4 version, just so you can see how pros do it. You know what I mean? Next question.
Okay, tweets. If you want to tweet us, it's at Computer Game Pod on Twitter. Robot Monkey says, did any of you buy the classic Mini NES? Do you think it's worthwhile buying or just a cynical cash grab from Nintendo?
I don't think anyone of us bought it, did they?
No, but it's sold out everywhere, isn't it?
Yeah, apparently they're like gold dust now.
They go over hundreds on eBay.
I mean, whether or not Nintendo, just didn't make enough of them, who knows? People who've got them seem to be really enjoying it.
Yeah, I don't think it's a needless cash in. I just, I've got no interest in getting one.
Yeah.
I already own all those games on Wii U, like through Virtual Console. Why would I buy them again? You know,
because it's Nintendo.
Mind you, I will be buying them again when the Switch comes out. So yeah, there is that.
Fair point.
I've just checked. Virginia is actually down to $4.99 until the 24th of November.
Yeah, you've got to buy that. It's right, really worth it.
We'll do.
It's interesting.
What's that on PSN?
PS4.
Cool. Okay, cool. Next question.
I think Alan says, can we have Tamor back? No.
Not after his last showing. Jesus. Oh, I've got to go. Bye. No, Timur. No. You'll have to wait until I'm off next. I've got disagreements over his
Mass Effect 3 opinions as well, but, you know, is that too?
What? Okay. Why?
God, the whole thing with, like, the ending. Like, I mean, it's true that it's lazy to say that was the whole problem with the whole game, but you can't just dismiss it. It's as being like a not a problem.
You can't dismiss it, but you can't dismiss the fucking 39 hours that you played for a brilliant game before you get to the last hour and just focus on that.
No, I totally agree, but also, yeah, it still is a big problem.
Ten past midnight, guys. 10 past midnight.
Okay. Anyway, Bert Hines says, "What game has the best AI and why?" I don't know. I don't really care. It's 10 past midnight.
It'll be one of them strategy games for weirdos.
I like the AI in Bioshock Infinite for Elizabeth. Was it Elizabeth? I think it was.
good character she was, yeah.
She was brilliant.
Whatever her name was.
I'm terrible with names at the best of times, Sean. I can't.
I
should have called you Gavin then for a gag, but fuck it.
That would have been good.
Probably that. 10 past midnight.
Okay.
Last one.
Okay. Leith Knight says, will these mid-gen console revisions mean we get games that don't push the hardware as much? Is a 3-year cycle the norm? The new norm?
I think that's the saddest thing about this. We're not going to get a GTA 5 on an Xbox 360 again. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely not. Because
whatever devs do, it's just going to be like, well, you know, there'll be new hardware in a few years. So we just, like, I think in terms of...
Yeah.
Yeah, like in terms of like wanting to rinse the most out of it, they'll just be like, well, we could do that. Or we could just like make it look really nice and it runs at 10 frames a second, but there'll be a new one next year and it'll run all right on that probably.
I think we might.
I'm not saying like developers will do that cynically or like, ah, fuck this, it's fine. I just, there are a lot of constraints on big budget game development. And I think it will, cause a shift in priorities.
I think we might see that again. And I think to some extent we've already seen it. I mean, Uncharted 4 running on the PS4 is, although PS4 is still relatively new hardware, it is still mind-blowing that game is running on that system as well as it does. Graphically, it's insane. But I think it'll be very limited to first-party software rather than third-party. I think third-party will have that mentality of, look, let's just make sure it runs fine and then we'll put all the power into the next one. Whereas the first party ones, I think they'll still be focusing on the older systems. So maybe we'll still see some surprising stuff on these now kind of outdated consoles. Fucking 3 years into their life.
Yeah, but it's interesting. Apparently, Sony internally are referring to the standard PS4 as the base model. Almost to say, you know, that's almost like minimum spec PC wise. But if you want to, you know, do like max settings or whatever, then you get the pro version. So it's going to be so interesting the next 6 months to a year to see if that really, really takes flight. And PS4 version looks fine, but they really focus on putting a lot of their effort into making a banging pro version.
Nice. Okay, then. Well, that's it for this week. I can't believe we went on for that long. But it has been a couple of weeks since James and I was on, so I suppose we had a lot to talk about. Matt, do you want to do your plug-in?
Absolutely, yeah. We're on Twitter, we're at Computer Game Pod on Twitter, we're also on Facebook, we're on Twitch, although we don't really stream, we haven't streamed for a while, but we're also on YouTube, and new episodes of the show go up every Wednesday on our YouTube channel. Just search for The Computer Game Show on YouTube, and you can also email us at thecomputergameshow@gmail.com.
Quick question, Matt. Before we leave our listeners, you wanted to do a short section at the end of the show about the election, right? Do you still want to do that at 9:15?
No, might leave it.
Good. I'll catch you all next week. Thanks for living it. Keep it the Computer Game Show. Goodbye.